Championship football on Channel 13. Today we have the Midget Championship for you. The team in the blue there, the St. James Rods, are going to be traveling over to St. Vital to play the Mustangs in the red uniforms. This is a Midget action coming to you from St. Vital Memorial Park. I'm Bob Whitlaw along with Tom Sherbrooke, Larry Bowden, and we're really looking forward to doing this ball game today. We had a chance to see this team, these teams, 2 weeks ago, and Tom, I know we were treated to about 70 points of offense, and you were just drooling at that ball game.
Well, I believe St. James had scored something like 40 points, and St. Vital had in the 30s, and there was a lot of offense that game, and I'm expecting to see that sort of thing again today.
There's a shot of some of the fans checking in for today's action. Larry, I don't think you had a chance maybe to see St. James for a while. I know you were out here and saw the Rods not too long ago.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sorry, the Mustangs not too long ago.
Right, well, I seen the Mustangs play last week, last few minutes of the game, to watch them defeat the Fort Garry Lions. It was a real close struggle. And about 3 weeks ago, Bob Skobar and myself did a game featuring the St. James Rods against Brandon Crocus Plainsmen. And the Rods just impressed me with their great size. They're led on defense by number 57, Jason Rawhouse, who's one of the finer linebackers in the Midget League. And St. Patel defensively, Renny Russo, number 82, is a person to watch. He's got good quickness and strength. And another defensive player, an outside linebacker, number 95, Richard Zoltanko, all the way from the north end, the Maples.
That's right, Larry. And on your screen there, we see the teams getting ready for the kickoff. It looks like the Rods are going to be kicking off to St. Patel. What are the dangerous return men deep there for St. Patel? I see Rob Palmer and the other man over there, number 80. We were impressed with him in that game we saw, Tom.
That's Steve Weiser, and I believe in that game we did, Bob, Steve Weiser picked up at least 2 touchdown passes for the Mustangs.
He was kind of the sleeper out there. It looked like St. James would bear down on Kensley Palmer, one of the running backs, and sure enough, it was some of the lesser lights that were coming through for the Mustangs in that game.
St. Patel utilized Steve Weiser on play-action passing, and I'm sure we're going to see that sort of scheme in their attack today.
Tom, different attitude towards the way the teams got up for the game. St. Patel came out all fired up, screaming, ranting, shades of an old college team. The Rods just came walking on, all business, like no emotion, just came out, went to their cow. They're down to play football, not jump around.
We'll just see if all
There's
that emotion
Martin
pays off.
Kicking off for the Rods is kind of a poor kick, and it's just covered there by the Mustangs. They're going to have a pretty decent field position around their 33-yard line.
Well, that was number 44, Chris Wieringa, and he's the left tackle on the offensive line for St. Patel. The left guard is 65 Kineski, the center is 66 Milligan, the right guard is 46 Hawash, and the right tackle is 67 French.
Well, first off for the Mustangs. Yeah, go ahead, Larry.
Yeah, defensively, the Rods are going to be sitting in a 5-3-4 setup. They're going to have 5 down linemen. They may bounce around a little bit, be stand-up ends, but we'll have to look for their big linemen. What a huge defense they've got, Tom.
Yeah, I see Lou Cassie, the former Maples Marauder star, starts at quarterback here for the Mustangs. And the first play, no flags, but the St. James blitz comes through there. 65 making the play for St. James.
Yeah, 65 is a big nose guard, Turner. He got across the line of scrimmage and really plugged up the offensive line. Maybe we'd give a little credit to lineman right now. Number 70, the end, Larrigan. Number 53 is Margulis. 65 is Turner. 51 is Schneider, 40 is Hannah. The outside linebackers, number 30, Scarlett, number 18, Kelly. Middle linebacker is Rawhouse, number 57. The corners are Johnson, 36, Steinhubel, 17. Defensive halfbacks, Reynolds, number 3, and Nathaniel, number 22.
Yeah, we had 2 flags thrown on that last play. Offside St. James, so nice 1st and 5 situation here for the Mustangs as we're just underway here in this Midget Championship football game. Here's a good shot of the Mustangs give to Kinsley Palmer, the big running back, and he just pops straight through there, but good defense by the Rods.
Yeah, once again, Turner got across and stopped the running back before he could really get a little gap into the defense. That fine running back for the St. Patel Mustangs, Tom, he's used to gaining a lot of yards up the middle.
Yeah, that's Kinsley Palmer. He's number 38. We're going to see him carrying the ball quite often today. That time he ran off tackle to the left, and St. Vital right now has come out in the I formation. They got two slots over here on the right.
Yeah, second and long two. They pitched to Palmer. He's turned in. He lost his footing, but he lowers his shoulder and easily picks up the first down.
Well, it was second and two on the play, Bob, and St. Vital came out with a formation where they had overloaded with both slots on the right side. There was a little pitch out to Palmer, number 38, and he had 33, Steve James, blocking for him. And they needed two, and they probably got about five. We just see the tail end of the play. Palmer did a lot of that himself. He got some good blocks, but he did a lot of that himself.
Number 40, Hannah, got across the line of scrimmage. He's lined up on the right side, got across the line of scrimmage with the read and made the tackle on Palmer behind, but not after first down.
First down Mustangs. Cassie barks out the signals. He gives inside to 85. A good defense. A nice penetrating defense, Larry.
That's right. Their whole line there is 51 Schneider, number 40. Jason Hanna got across the line of scrimmage and stacked up the running back before he could even get the... He barely got the ball.
Well, that was like a slot back handoff. Ball Palmer lined up on the right, and he was going left. And I noticed number 46, the right guard, Hallwash, was trapping on the play. Now, you talked about penetration, and perhaps somebody penetrated through the hole that Hallwash left as he trapped down the line.
Well, five big linemen like the Rods have, they're going to shoot across that line of scrimmage hard all the time.
Second and 12. They quick pitch. Palmer wants to pass. The ball's underthrown. 36. Oh, he dropped the ball. Good call by the officials. Great position to call it.
That's a cornerback, Johnson. He had good position on the coverage. He wasn't fooled by that sort of halfback option pass. He just didn't hang on to the ball.
Well, he kept his eye on the receiver that he was covering, and also he looked back in the backfield, and he could see that Palmer was about to throw the ball. It was thrown short. Here we see it on the replay. There's Palmer loading up, and he was intending to pass to number 80, Weiser, and 36 for the Rods. That would be Johnson had just dropped the ball. So it's third down. St. Vital is going to be punting.
Good camera work. Went right through his hands, hit the ball.
Yeah, Richard Zoltenko, another Maples Marauder, back to punt here for the Mustangs. He takes his time. There's a nice driving end over end kick. It's going to be fielded by, I think, 27 there. I think that's Jones. Oh, there's a good-looking return. Back up to the 50-yard line. Good field position for St. James.
Flag on the play, Bob, so it may be coming back. We'll just have to see what the officials call us.
One thing I noticed with this St. James Rod team, the game Bob Skobar and myself did about 3 weeks ago, was the great job their punt return unit does. And there we see the penalty is against the St. Vital Mustangs. They're calling a procedure, but the Rods aren't taking it. They'll take the ball on their own 50-yard line.
Yeah, Gary Slobodian, the head official there today.
So St. James is going to come out on offense for their first series of the game, and they're led by their quarterback, number 5, Chad McKay.
Yeah, I was very impressed with Chad 2 weeks ago when I saw him play that game out of Westwood Collegiate against the same Mustang team. That was a good high-scoring game with St. James in control most of the ball game. This time, they just quick pitch left here. I think that's Ogwell with the ball. He's got good interference, but 82 makes a nice play, and there's a flag in the play.
Yeah, 82 is Rene Russo, the rover back that they've got in there. The St. Vital Mustangs today are sitting in a 4-4 with the rover. At end, they have Martin and Bonnie. At the tackles, they have Swarick and Kolinsky. Outside linebackers, Merrithew and Zoltenko. Inside linebackers, Carlson and Dalgleish. The rover is Russo. The corners are Sinuk and George, and the safety is Miller.
Okay, and here we see the replay. There's the pitch. Ogwald's coming outside here to the left. Flag on the play, and it was holding against
was
St.
Holding.
James.
You know what, fellas, that Rene Russo didn't play in that last game between these two teams. I know he's a dominating kind of linebacker.
He sure is. He had a bit of a neck injury, and they decided to rest him out in that game, and it was a big loss for the St. Vital Mustangs.
First and 20 for the Rods. We'll see what they come up with in this situation. Again, McKay's the quarterback there, number 5 for the Rods in the blue. He just gives the second man, Ogwell, a big hole opens. He straight arms one of the tacklers, and a nice pickup, about an 11-yard pickup, Tom.
Well, so far in the game, I've been very impressed with the blocking of the St. James offensive line. On the pitch play previously, we saw 67 Decker get out. He's playing the left tackle, get out and throw a nice block. There was a big hole there between the left guard and the left tackle. It was worth about a 12-yard gain. And right now, St. James seems to be winning the battle on the line.
Now, there you can see on the line of scrimmage, he just pops right through. Now, St. Vital has to get across the line of scrimmage. They have to chop up those big linemen for the Rods. They can't fight out muscle, and there's no chance.
Second and 8 for the Rods. They quick pitch to the right this time. Same back, Ogwell with the ball. He got a good initial block. He's got good speed. He's got the first down, and he's knocked out of bounds down about the 38-yard line. Good play, St. James.
Well, the pitch play is going to work if St. James is able to block those outside perimeter men. And that time, number 32, Schwab, made a nice block, I believe, on the outside backer.
Right.
And number 55, Christian, he's the right tackle. He also led the play as well. They
kicked out the linebacker. Good job by the back to set it up, cut back inside, gained a lot of yards on that play.
First down for St. James here as they're on the march here early in the first quarter. This is Midget Championship action coming to you from safe at Talbot Royal Park. There's the pass. Oh, two receivers in the same area. Incomplete, nearly intercepted.
Well, I thought it was kind of hard to decide who the ball was intended for. It was play action passing. Two receivers in the area, number 32 Schwab, who came out of the backfield into the flat, and also 38 Newberry, who was lined up outside and running it out. And here we see the quarterback play action pass, and the ball's going to fall right in between them. There's 32 and 38.
Well, the kind of touch he put on the ball, it looked like he was trying to tend it for the back leaking out number 32.
Second and 10 for St. James. We'll just let the play unfold for you here, and the quarterback McKay just gives it to Ogwald, but he's boxed in. He reverses his field, and he wants to pass. Oh, wide open with 73. I don't know if it was a design play, but a planned play.
Well, I don't think it was a design play, but I'm amazed how quickly he thought of using that alternative option, and he ran this way. He ran towards us with the ball on a simple handoff and saw that he was in some difficulty, stopped, and I'm surprised he could see anybody open downfield.
Possibly it could be a planned play. Look at the linemen. They don't go downfield. They're all pretty well along the line of scrimmage.
That's what I couldn't believe, Larry. I didn't see one lineman downfield except that intended receiver, and he just
was
nearly
wide
turned
open
into a big play. Here's a Scarlet doing the punting for St. James. It's just an average punt coming down around the 5. And I think that's one of the lowest number 80, I think, Weiser at the ball. And they're up to the 10-yard line. First down, save a towel. There's
good coverage
of
down by the
team's players coming off on there.
Nice coverage by the Rods downfield. They really limited the St. Patel gain to on the return to about 4 yards. It'll be first down inside their own 15-yard line.
This early in the game, we've already seen both teams employ option passes. Palmer threw one before that was almost intercepted by St. James, and that time Chris Ogwald was trying to hit number 73 downfield.
Yeah, the old sister Spartan offense.
Let's see what the Mustangs can come up with.
Everybody uses that play.
They've got 100 yards to go for a touchdown here. The quarterback, they just give the ball, I think, on a kind of wingback around play, but St. James just stuffs a good defensive play.
Ball carrier was number 22, Derek Lee, and once again, too much penetration by the St. James defense.
Big number 65, Daryl Turner, got across the line of scrimmage, wrapped up the quarterback, got help from number 70, Ladigan. There's C on the replay. There's Turner getting through and had a bit of help by number 70, Ladigan, but a great job by both linemen. If they keep dominating the line like this, Tom, St. Patel's in for a long day.
Well, nobody blocked Turner, number 65. We saw him just penetrate right into the backfield, and perhaps he's shooting gaps between pulling offensive linemen. I'm not sure, but these outside plays that are taking a little while to develop aren't going to work for St. Patel.
Second and 17 situation for the Mustangs. We'll see if Cassie puts the ball in the air or a draw play or what's going to happen here. They just give it to, I just missed the number there, I think.
Tackle was made by Johnson on the play, number 36. Good job by the running back to break a couple of blocks, Tom. Or tackles,
well, yeah, it was number 38, Palmer. That time it was a little pitch, but Palmer was situated almost behind his right tackle or even outside of the tackle. So they have the man exactly where they want him to be. And no one blocked number 18.
Or 70.
Boy, that's
or
good.
Three.
That's good defense, Larry. They're just swarming that blue defense.
Well, they're so big and so strong that really St. Patel has to use a lot of deception plays. Counters possibly.
Play action passing.
Something to freeze those linemen because they're just coming hard. They got that five down lineman set up. They're just shooting.
Perhaps cross. Screens. Maybe
screens
blocks.
Could possibly work also.
There's a shot of Zoltenko. He's 5 yards deep at his end zone. Oh, the kick was touched there. Even though St. Patel's got the ball, it's going to be St. James.
And the amazing thing about it was the man who blocked it, number 70, John Larrigan, didn't even jump off the ground. He just put his hands up.
Zoltenko took a lot of time to get rid of the ball. And really, like you said, that big Larrigan just stood there.
Yeah, I just sort of ambled towards the punter, put his hands up. We're going to see it again on the replay.
Like a big bear.
Here's Zoltenko about to kick the ball. And there's number 70, just puts his hands up.
I don't think the ball traveled over the line of scrimmage. I'm not sure about that. Or maybe it just did there, judging where that third down marker was. And
really?
You've got to give yards in that
situation.
I think
that's the most casual punt block we've seen.
That's right. It was sort of like slow motion.
Well, St. James has got excellent field position.
But really, right now, the St. James grabbed their own ball. The punt, they didn't get a first down, even if that would be the ruling. But there was no yards given. It's an interesting call. The officials right now are talking to both teams' captains. And the Rod sure had a lot of captains, didn't they, Tom?
Well, it appeared as if they had 20.
Fellas, just while there's captains. A little pause in the action here, I want to remind our viewers that we're the first game you saw tonight went 2.5 hours. We just have about an hour and a half left to do this midget game in, so we're going to have to edit certain parts of the game. We hope this won't cause any inconvenience. We're not going to edit out any scoring plays, naturally, so some of you viewers who were at the game, there might be some bits and pieces missing, but we're not going to miss any of the important action, believe me.
Well, there's a couple of penalties on the play, and they're talking to St. James Rod's captains. It looks like St. Fatel's going to be punting once again. We'll have to see what the call is, Tom.
Now, if there had been no penalties on the play, the very fact that St. James touched the ball and the Mustangs recovered it, what would be the ruling on that?
It would have been St. James' ball where the Mustangs jumped on it. If the ball didn't cross the line of scrimmage, if it did, then there's a no-yard penalty.
I cannot believe that is not St. James's ball, regardless of what went on there. I mean, the kick was blocked.
Well, there possibly could have been some penalty, Bob.
Because there wouldn't have to be no yards on a punt, would there, that's been blocked?
If it crosses the line of scrimmage,
well,
I believe it does, yes.
We need an official up here with us.
Maybe it didn't cross the line of scrimmage, but whatever.
It was an interesting.
It's taking too long to sort out, whatever.
Well, let's see. Keep an eye on the head
this
official
might be a good time
and see
for
what
editing.
He's saying. That's right.
Kooky Bear, edit.
Anyway, St. James is ready to receive the punt. Should it come downfield, Patrick Jones, number 27, is back. And I believe Patrick is some relation to Milson Jones of
That's
the Edmonton
right,
Eskimos.
That's right, too. Cousin, possibly? Or?
And also number 17, Greg Steinhubel is back.
What a break for the Mustangs.
Well,
wow.
We didn't find out what the call was, but it's third down over, and let's see if Saul Tinkle can get this ball away, or if number 17 will jump to try to block it this time.
Oh, number 18 from the side. He was home free, and probably if they... Oh. Touchdown.
That's covered by number 53, Maragles, a defensive tackle, a lineman's dream. A good job by number 18, Kelly, to get across the line of scrimmage. Got to the punter. Zoltenko, again, didn't really have much protection. And here we see on the replay.
You know, I watched him all the way, Larry, number 18. Nobody blocks him, but I wondered if he'd ever get there. But sure enough, he did a terrific job there blocking that kick. That's Rob Kelly.
Well, you know, like they say, you did it once, and shame on you. Do it twice, shame on me. And Richard Zoltenko took a little bit too much time, I think, Tom, to get rid of the ball.
He took a little bit of a step to his right.
Oh, there's a high step, but they get it down, and 73 Martin puts it through for the convert, and St. James jumps out 7-0. Do you believe that? Two block kicks in a row.
Getting back to the second block punt that resulted in a touchdown, I watched Zoltenko. He seemed to take a little step to the right, and that's exactly in the path that Kelly took to get to the punter.
And Zoltenko, being a right-footed kicker, you want to rush from the defense's left because you'll get that shorter distance to go to the ball. You don't have to cross the body to try to block the ball. And Kelly did a good job. He got right across, made his launching point a couple of yards ahead of the punter, Zoltenko. And number 53, Margulies, there you see on the screen, a happy young man, scored a touchdown. Not too often defensive linemen get to jump up and down the end zone with the ball.
Here's a great camera shot of the very happy St. James players.
Well, Rods are going to be kicking off again. And the first time they kicked off, they seemed to have some kind of confusion with all their players milling around behind the kicker. But right now, they're lined up in traditional fashion.
There's Martin. He gets a pretty good kick away this time. Oh, it goes over Weiser's head, but he's got it at the 10. And he gives it on a reverse to Kensley Palmer this side of the field. Palmer's got good speed. And finally, will the troops arrive? Yes, they do. Number 36 with a tackle for St. James.
Well, we saw the reverse on the kickoff. Kensley Palmer coming from left to the right, and he got a great block thrown by his brother, 85 Bob Palmer. And Bob was able to take down number 18 for the Rods. That's Kelly, the man that blocked the punt. And that block sprung Kensley open. We're going to see the replay here. Here's Weiser getting the ball. He's going to come... there, he's
now watch
it,
number.
Now watch the block, boom, right
watch
there.
Watch number 13, too, at the top of your screen there, right in the back, and that's what the penalty's being called. Sean Ruddle for clipping or blocking from
anyway,
the rear.
Bob Palmer had thrown a nice block for Kensley, and it was a good-looking return, but it's going back. So St. Patel's going to start a little deeper, probably about their 15-yard line.
You know, fellas, St. Patel's got to just to get a little momentum back here, drive the ball for a few first downs, not get fancy, just run the ball. They got James and Kensley Palmer there. They're two running backs. They're real solid performers. There's a fake for Palmer. Cassie wants to pass wide open. It's Rob Palmer. But 23's got pretty good position on it for St. James.
That 22, number 22, the defense halfback who had man coverage on play, Nathaniel, got across the play action pass, Tom.
Guess what, though? It's procedure penalty against St. Vital, so it's coming back. But we talked about deception, Larry, and that time we saw play action pass, big fake there to Palmer. See the fake? And Cassie semi-rollout sees Palmer in the flat, but it's coming back.
Well, you know, even if you would have given the ball to the person he faked to, he faked it to the other Palmer.
Yeah.
He had a big hole.
Oh, he did.
He could have went a long way. But
it's procedure against St. Vital, and like nothing is working for St. Vital right now. Two punts have been blocked. Not a bad kickoff return. It came back because of a penalty. That was a fine-looking play. That's coming back because of a penalty. They just haven't got things going yet this early in the game.
Well, if the plays are working and they're called back because of penalties, hopefully you can correct the penalties and they'll continue to work.
Here's a first and 15 play. Oh, Cassie's getting all kinds of pressure. He unloads it under duress, incomplete, and boy, did he take a hit on that play.
Well, that was play action pass again, and Cassie scrambled to his left. He had 85 Palmer downfield, and also number 11, Weeb, was in the vicinity, but it goes incomplete, so it's second down.
Cassie did a good job. He rolled to his right, found that he had just a massive rush coming from Larrigan, number 70, 53 Margulies. He reversed his field, and, you know, good composure for a young quarterback to look downfield and throw it, even though it was incomplete. A tough play. I sure wouldn't want to be a quarterback.
The way Cassie's throwing the ball, Tom, where he really looks crisp. I know that was overthrown, but he's throwing the ball well.
He's throwing it under some duress, though.
Yeah, second and 15. He wants to go back to number 80 Weiser. It's high again. Oh, there's a punishing hit by Johnson. He timed it very well.
It's a legal hit. He didn't really have to do it, but, you know, you're allowed to take the man down if the ball is thrown and it was slightly overthrown.
Well, it's play action pass again. Fake to number 38 Palmer in the middle. And I guess the receiver had run a post pattern, and actually he was open, I think. But just a bad pass by Cassie.
Well, the receiver was open. He did have the angle on the defensive back there, but it was just a matter, as you mentioned, the ball was overthrown.
Do I hear the strains of a marching band in the background somewhere?
That's right. It's just like being at Notre Dame University.
That's right.
Saturday afternoon.
They're marching in from the golf course behind us. And
St. Vital's called a timeout here. I think they want to double-check their blocking on this punting play here.
I think so, because it is third down, and St. Vital will be punting, and
they called a timeout there. I guess they wanted to get everything set for the punt.
Perhaps they may want to narrow their splits down a little bit in terms of their punting team. And there we see the, I was just talking about a band and the hearing the strains in the background, and sure enough, there they are.
And there goes our chairs. Warm and comfortable.
This never happens to Don Whitman.
I guess not.
There's the band.
And there goes our chairs.
Yep, they're gone too. Oh, well, third down for St. Vital. And remember, the last time they punted the ball, they had two punts blocked.
Well, I think the reason they called a... Oh, look at that.
Oh! Number 18 made a silly play that time for St. James.
Well, number 18, Kelly, went racing in there. Zoltanko took the punt. He was giving up 2 points, and 18 just flew over him. There's no reason for that, Kelly. A rather cheap sort of attitude to take. The punter on the replay, you can see he's down for a long time, and Kelly comes to try to take off his head. That's a shameful display of sportsmanship as far as I'm concerned.
And the ball comes out to the 45 here. We'll wait for the indication from the official what happened there exactly.
Well, I don't think we'll see the 2 points given up.
Oh, I think we do, Larry, yes, but 15 yards onto the kickoff here.
Really?
The official did give the indication.
I guess they might have blown the whistle, too. And
the 2 points were given for the safety touch. The rough play penalty against the runs will be tacked onto the kickoff.
There's a signal from the official, Gary Slobodian.
Yep, they tacked on the rough play to the kickoff, Tom.
Okay, so Iowa stands as 9-0 right now, and the St. James, I guess, punt turn team or punt return team or punt block team has been responsible for all the points so far today.
I'm very disillusioned by, you know, that last play. I hate to see that kind of thing happen in amateur sports, especially with young kids high school age.
There's Altenko kicking the ball off. It's going to come down. Let's see who's got it. 17 has Steinhubel there for St. James. He's got good speed. He comes right up the middle. And the blocking's there. Greg, oh, he just about broke it. He's up to the 53-yard line. Great return by that John Taylor track star, Greg Steinhubel.
Well, that's number 17, as you call it, Bob. Greg Steinhubel. The return was basically a middle return, and he seemed to have a lot of blockers running with
him. There was just a blue wave coming through there.
A blue wave is right.
Oh.
Well, they have an excellent return team, the St. James Rods, too. They've got Steinhubel, they've got Ogwell, they've got Jones. You know, it's just an endless amount of people that they could put in there. Yeah. And there we see Steinhubel running right up the middle.
Take a look at all these blue jerseys providing interference for number 17, Steinhubel.
One block away from a touchdown. Nice tackle by number 16, Scott Brand.
Yeah, we hope you viewers are enjoying this Sunday night football for a little different treat for you.
Inside running by number 32, Blaine Schwab. Some kind of trap action on the play. One of the interior linemen had trapped. I think it was probably Christian, the right guard. And it's a gain of five.
Yeah, 5 yard pickup, second and five.
St. James is basically employing one tight, one split, two slots, and two running backs.
McKay remains in at quarterback. Chad McKay, they move into a double tight end. They give to Ogwald. He makes a nice little deep, lowers his shoulder, and very close to a face basket by Sabatel, but no call.
On that play there, I seen them switching it. Could that have been an audible? They called a black color, and it seems like the whole offense just switched.
Now we're going to see off tackle coming here to the left. And there's Ogwald, darts in and out, and looked pretty close to a face mask
there.
That
was Chris Merrihew almost got the call. I saw Tony Kerr reaching for his back pocket, but he couldn't find it, and then it never did come out.
Check the other pocket, possibly.
So it's going to be third down for St. James, and we'll probably see... No, we're not going to see Neville Scarlett.
Well, third down
the ball,
of one.
They're going for it.
They're
going
to go right up the middle for it with that big line.
There's a gift to Ogwald, and he's got the first down. Good tackle down low by 82. We talked about him earlier. That's Russo.
Well, Ogwald was the only back in the backfield. He took the handoff rather deep, and he just looks for daylight. And he saw it off tackle to the left behind Decker, and I believe 76 Swan or Martin was over on that side. And here we see it again. Taking the handoff pretty deep in the backfield allows him to see where his daylight is.
Did you see the offensive line of that play, Tom? They just pushed back the defensive line 5 yards. Ogle had no problem getting the first down.
4 minutes remaining here in the first quarter. St. James out 9-0. They've defeated Sabatel twice this year in league matchups. The St. James finishing first. There's the gift to Jones. He beats the first man, takes it outside, and he beats the second man, turns it up, but good defense by Sabatel this time.
Well, it was good defense by Sabatel. They just kept coming all the time, and no sooner was Jones past one defender, and he had another one, and Sabatel strung that out laterally very well. I noticed when St. James came out over the ball, both slot backs went in motion and switched positions, and that set it up so that Jones could go to the wide side of the field.
Well, the defensive end of that play, 76 Martin, did a good job getting across the line of scrimmage and forced the running back to bubble further back and made his route a lot longer than he wanted it to be.
There's McKay, nice looking pass to Schwab, and he's going to be short of a first down. It's complete down around the 35-yard line.
Well, that's a very popular play. I've seen a lot of teams using that in their offense, and it's a play-action pass out of the eye with the first back just leaking out into the flat. The second back gets the fake from the quarterback.
Well, good job by number 57 for the Mustangs. That's Carlson, who got across the line. Kept his eye on the man, stuck right with him. The pass is well thrown, but good defense by Carlson.
Yeah, Neville Scarlett, the punter, checks into the game with about four reserve players, so that usually indicates punt for the Rods. And once again, if the special team does a good job here for the Rods, they should pin Sabatel pretty deep.
Well, they have one person back, so perhaps they're going for the block.
There's a driving spiral down to the end zone. He might give up a point here. We'll wait and see. No, he decides to take it out. He's knocked back into the end zone. And actually, it's the best thing that could have happened for St. James. He's out to the 5-yard line. And the Rods pin the Mustangs deep.
Well, I think we saw Kesley Palmer use a nice straight arm right at the goal line. A tackler could have had him right in the vicinity of the goal posts. And if we see it again on the replay, we're going to see Palmer throw a straight arm. And it's not often that you see the straight arm utilized much anymore.
Well, number 70 got downfield very fast for the St. James Rods. That's John Larrigan, and he just grabbed the hold of Palmer. I'm surprised the size of that kid and the speed that he has, Tom.
Yeah, is that John Larrigan? That's the casual punt blocker. Here we see the replay, and here's Palmer. Now look at the straight arm. Oh, nice job. And 67's down there. That's Decker, eh? Yeah, Decker.
67 was Decker, yep.
Yeah, we saw him,
good
I think, in some Batman games last year. Big lineman, good mobile kid, that's for sure. There's a give just straight off left tackle. That's Kensley Palmer again, the older brother of Rob. Carries the ball for a nice pickup.
Straight ahead give, Palmer.
Yeah, it was off tackle play to the right, probably out of the eye, and Steve James would be the lead blocker. And the play had a certain quickness to it that made it be successful for about 7 yards.
Well, that quickness really took the defensive line by the of the rods by surprise. They weren't even set in their stance yet. They came up, Bloomway had him, made the tackle, but not after about a 9 yard
yeah
game.
I said seven, but actually it was nine. They must have gone on sound on that play.
Well, the rods defense does a lot of jumping around before the ball is snapped.
Yeah, here's a second one. They get to the second back. That's Palmer. He just breaks through, puts a move on the last man, and there's a nice 12-yard pickup.
Okay, Saint Patel came out. It was pretty interesting. They had the two slots lined up on the left side, making St. James think, okay, we're overloaded on the left. They'll probably be coming left, and instead they went right.
Good
and
blocking.
And there's Palmer. Gets past that line of scrimmage and sees some daylight, and it takes three St. James rods to bring him down.
Well, Margulies, number 53, the boy who scored the only touchdown of the game, he got down low and tried to get Palmer around the ankles. He just couldn't hang on. Kensley's a tough running back to bring down.
Good crowd checking in for this championship midget football game. If viewers don't know, these boys are the same age as high schoolers. A gift to Rob Palmer, but he's just stuffed. I think St. James anticipated that play.
Well, that's the second time we've seen the slot back handoff or slot back sweep, and it doesn't appear like it's going to work today because two times St. James has shut it down with their penetration, and I believe they must be getting through the holes that the trapping or pulling guards are leaving when they break out of their stance.
There is absolutely no deception there. They just fire across the line of scrimmage as hard as they can and try to take away that yard.
I wonder if we could see it again, because I'd like to know where these holes are developing.
Right over top of people who are supposed to be blocking them from.
Oh, all along the line?
All along the line.
Okay.
Oh, there's a loose ball, I think. There's a scramble on for it. We'll see what happens, and we'll wait for the official. A good defense, regardless, by St. James again.
Well, the handoff was to number 33, James, and we must have had some kind of mishandling of the ball. Anyway, St. Patel comes up with it, and it will be third down. Let's see it again here. Here's Cassie. Hands off to number 33, James.
Great play by 51 for St. James, I think, to cause that fumble.
Yeah.
Well, on that play there, I believe the Rods are in some kind of blitzing formation because they had the linebackers across line scrimmage very hard. Number 51, Schneider, who plays the defensive end position, got across very hard to hit the running back just as he touched the ball. And it was good job by Cassie to jump on the ball ahead of number 30 for the Rods, and that's Neville Scarlett.
It's time for St. Patel to punt, and this should be an exciting play.
You know, I think the St. Patel coaches will be glad to hear that gun go to end this first quarter. Maybe they'll regroup here. It's been all St. James with the indicators here. Jones returns the ball down to about the 39-yard line.
Well, you know, number 51 that time was pretty close for St. James, and that's Brian Schneider.
You know, you block one person, you've got another two or three to go, but that ends the first quarter, and the score is St. James Rods 9, St. Patel Mustangs no score. Tom, recap?
Okay, St. James had two punt blocks of two successive punt blocks. The first one was nullified by a penalty, and then they went and did it again. Number 18 Kelly blocking Zoltenko's punt. It was recovered by 53 Alan Margulies in the end zone for a St. James touchdown. Martin provided the convert. That made it 7-0 for St. James. Then the next time St. Patel had a punting situation, Zoltenko just went down on a knee in the end zone, giving up the safety touch, and it's 9-0.
Well, in this midget league action, they play 15-minute quarters, unlike high school, which is 12 minutes. Very similar to what you find in junior.
St. James, great field position. They get to the big back, Schwab. He just powers about 3 yards off left tackle. This time, St. Patel with some real good defense.
Okay, Schwab carrying the ball off tackle to the left, and I noticed the slot back on the left, 17, Steinhubel, gave some kind of belly action, belly motion, a deep sort of motion in the backfield, and I think we're probably going to see them give it to Steinhubel eventually.
Good job by the defense then, Glenn Bonney, number 47, to fight off his man and make the tackle down low and stop it, limiting the gain to about 2 yards.
Look at that crowd. Just great to see that support for midget football here in Winnipeg. Midget, a good 17 league. There's Ogwall going wide left at 75. He's got position, but look at 17. What a hit for St. Patel.
Well, did you notice the offensive line on that play, Tom? They got right around the corner, didn't have to throw a block until they were about 5 yards downfield.
That was a pitch play. Ogwall carrying the ball, and 67 was out there blocking, and I was really impressed with the job done by number 32. Now, if we can keep our eyes on him, Schwab. Well, he's just a little further downfield here.
Watch 17 there, fellas. What a
hit. Good job by 17.
Almost, right through the drums there.
Yeah, that's Jason George. He came across really hard. And that would have been an interesting shot. Helmet going through the bass drum.
But the bottom line is first down Rods, and they're just dominating here early in the game. Always enjoying good field position, it seems like. There's McKay. He wants to pass this time. He's a pretty good scrambler. He's going to maybe turn up field. Let's see, Zoltenko runs him out of bounds.
I watched Zoltenko on that play, and he had to cover the back in the flat, and then he also had to make the decision when to leave him if he saw that the quarterback was running. Maybe we'll get to see it again on the replay. What did you think of the job he did?
Did a pretty good job sticking with his man and forcing McKay to run the ball. What I was really impressed with was the speed of number 76, Martin Morton, the defensive end, who came across and forced McKay deeper than he wanted to go. Just didn't have that extra speed. Now, I'm surprised St. Vitale on a roll out there doesn't send their outside linebacker, in that case number 95, Zoltenko, up to force the quarterback before he can get outside.
No, he had the man in the slot that play, all right.
That's right.
Second and six, they give Dogwell straight ahead, and he's going to be probably about a yard or two short of the first. That'll bring up an interesting maybe third one here for the Rods.
Good tackle by a linebacker, Dalgleish, number 75, got nice and low and wrapped up on the running back. Not much of a gain there, Tom.
Look at the size of those linemen going into the game.
Here comes the reinforcements, 50, 57, and 70.
Boy, they're making kids big. It's really nice to be able to do a midget championship game. They don't get the same kind of press coverage that high school does, and they have the same type of league, and it's really nice to see VPW out here doing this game.
There's Ogwell again. He picks his way through, should have the first down. They made it look easy. Although, mind you, it's hard to hold your ground when three guys are blocking you, but...
Glenn Bonney, number 47, was in on that tackle again, but not after a first down has been made by the St. James Rods. They're on the march again with 12 minutes and 45 seconds left in this first half. They're ahead 9-0 over the St. Vitale Mustangs.
But Larry, did you say you saw St. Vitale last week play Fort Garry? They had a real struggle in that ball game. I hear it was a very exciting, high-scoring game.
Well, I'll comment right after this.
There's
play.
There's Steinhobel with the ball. He's got pretty good interference. He turns it, knocked out of bounds, flags in the play.
Well, last week after a press conference, the three of us were at for that junior championship game, myself and, here's the replay, Tom.
Okay, we're just going to see, it's a slot back sweep, Steinhubel carrying the ball, and I thought St. Vitale did a good job making it go wide.
Yeah, myself and Tom Sherbert came back here and caught the last 3 minutes or so of the semifinal action between the St. Vitale Mustangs and the Fort Garry Lions. And it was really interesting to see. When we got to the game, it seemed like Fort Garry is really marching all over St. Vitale. And in my belief, if Fort Garry would have had another 2-3 minutes on the clock, or possibly even another 10 seconds, they could have won that game.
Well, anyway, there were too many men on the field for St. Vitale. It's going to be first down for St. James.
Yeah, looks like they're around the four-yard line, Tom. They just quick pitch left Ogwell. He's got the interference out there. If they can catch him, he straight arms the first man, turns it up, touchdown, St. James.
Well, you see, there's linemen out there. There's no one to block.
But, you know, they almost got him. And you're right, there were people out there blocking for him. Russo, 82, almost got him. We saw Decker out there, and we saw Schwab out there, and they were looking for people to block. What they should have done was turned and looked inside.
Right.
Stop and look. Now you see them both out there, and here come people from the inside, 82 and also 28.
Well, Russo, number 82, is a rover, and he's going to key on that running back in the backfield, and in that case, Ogwell. And really, he almost got him. Like you said, if those linemen would have just stopped as they got around the corner, they would have been able to pick him up. But it looks like the convert is good, and that'll make the score right now, Tom.
I have it at 16-0 in favor of St. James.
I really enjoyed that replay of the touchdown run, fellas. You could really see those guys get in position, though. They're getting out there. I noticed the run before that, Steinhubel, when he ran to the right side, there must have been three or four guys out there just interfering, not knocking people down, but somehow they were getting out and into position.
I was talking to Craig Bertrand, linebacker coach, and I believe defense coordinator for St. Vitale Mustangs before the game, and he said their defense would have to hold the St. James Rods early for them to have any success and let their offense get on the field a little bit, get cooking, get into the flow of the game. But this hasn't been the case in the first 18 minutes of this game. It's been all St. James Rods.
I'm not sure how long it's been since the Rods last won a midget title, but boy, they're well on their way today if they can maintain any of this momentum. There's Rob Palmer receiving the kickoff, a good defense this time. 43's got him there for St. James. Nice play by, that's Rod Hutter on the special teams.
Yeah, Rod Hutter's a backup linebacker for the Rods. He got down in his lane. No one really blocked him, Palmer. He just grabbed the hold of Palmer.
And it kind of looked like St. James was going for the ball there. It seemed a tackler or two was just trying to wrench it away from Palmer.
Yeah.
St. Vitale's going to start on offense, and they've had some problems today moving the ball downfield. Sometimes when they've executed some pretty good-looking plays, they've got penalties and the ball's had to come back. So
perhaps you're going to have to do some more play-action pass and throw it downfield. They're not having much success with their run.
First down, save and tell. They get to the second man, Palmer. He just keeps the legs driving, and he's got a nice six-yard pickup.
Well, Palmer should have probably bumped a little bit outside here to the left. It seemed
right.
Like he had some space, and he just continued following number 44, Waringa, who was the left tackle. And I think if Palmer just sort of glanced a little bit to his left, he had some yardage.
Yeah, Waringa's a graduate of the Peace Gardens of a couple years back, Palm, and he was out there as a defensive lineman under Kerry Raffey. I guess Kerry's old heart is broken out seeing the kid on the other side of the line. But a good job by Waringa opening the hole there.
Yeah, I saw Coach Raffey earlier today. He was out here watching some of that Bantam consolation play. Oh, there's a loose ball. Cassie picks it up and pays for it. It's going to be about a 3rd and 7 coming up here for the Mustangs.
The whole interior line, defensive line and linebackers of the Rods got in on the tackle, and someone gave him a good smack. The ball popped loose. Good job by Cassie watching where the ball was rolling, jumping on it, but he had no chance to go anywhere with the ball. There we see on the replay.
Well, you know, the last time these two teams played, St. Vital and St. James, we saw St. Vital employ play action passing and throwing the number 80 Weiser. And we haven't seen that yet today. And I'm thinking maybe they might attempt something like that.
Yeah, the punter's all tanko is getting a real workout here early in the game. He must have kicked about 4 times already. There's a nice driving kick. It's going to be handled by Jones down around the 30. He slips and he's whistled dead right there on the 26-yard line. 1st and 10, St. James.
Well, we mentioned before in amateur football, the minute that a knee touches the ground, the play is going dead. On that play, it looked like Jones just lost his footing in the soft turf in the center field part of the field.
That St. James offensive line has done a fine job today. The left tackle was Decker. The left guard is Dubeski, a boy we had out at the Peace Gardens.
Good kid.
The center is Hine. The right guard is 61 Christian, and the right tackle is 55 Lesick.
There's McKay. He wants to pass wide open. This side of the field was 27, but McKay didn't. I can't believe McKay didn't get the ball to him.
You're right, Bob. He was so wide open, and the kid was standing there jumping up and down, and it's like McKay couldn't see him.
There was no one there.
And then finally he threw it to him when he was covered. Maybe we'll get to see it again.
The quarterback role, I think the quarterback in some degree thought of maybe running with the ball himself, but here on the replay.
Here's McKay, and he's rolling out. You can't see Jones, but Jones is just wide open right in front of him.
Now
finally
he
throws it to Jones. But maybe McKay is a boy who really likes to, you know, complete passes with adversity rather than take the easy.
That's right, the easy completion.
Coach Rojas, another gray hair on that one. There's the quick pitch to Ogwell. They stay his student body left. Ogwell cuts it up. Nice tackle on the play. I think it's number 57 there for Shea Patel with a good hit.
Also, number 39 was in on the play there. That's Jason Sinnock. He's a defensive halfback, and he did a good job getting low on Ogwell.
Well, what do you think about this defensive strategy, Larry? And it's not often that I offer it. Well, we'll just see the replay here. And there's Ogwell. But how about St. Vital trying to stretch it as wide as they can on those pitches? That would probably be about the best thing they could do.
Or get a person into their big lineman.
He did a very poor job of dropping the ball there. When he kicked that ball, the point almost hit his foot there. Look at St. Vital gets great field position. The punt only travels about 15 yards over the line of scrimmage.
I think actually Scarlett should have hustled downfield. He might have been able to recover the ball for St. James.
Well, getting back to your question, I think defensively, I'd shoot those outside linebackers. And as soon as they seen those big blue linemen pull around the corner, just chop them up right there. Don't allow those guys get downfield. Even if they don't throw a block, they're so big they get in the way.
See, I'm thinking if they can get outside of the St. James pitch so that you can't beat us outside, you'll have to turn it up, and then our fill will get
and
you.
With a good linebacker like Russo, who's king on Ogwell, you can stop him all the time.
There's a straight ahead play for the Mustangs, probably a 3-yard pickup.
Flag flew there.
Flag there, and it looked like one of the St. Vital linemen had moved prematurely, but he got back, reset himself, and then the flag flew.
It is procedure against St. Vital, so it's going to be 1st and 15, and if the penalty's taken.
Looks like it is.
You know, St. Vital's been coming out on first down and calling the ball on sound, and they've had some success with it.
Well, with the St. James Rods, like to jump around a little bit, go to sort of overshift to the strong side to some degree. Perhaps counteraction back the other way, Tom, would have some more success for these poor St. Vital Mustangs. They've really had no success at all on offense.
Well, they haven't thrown to their outside receivers yet. Maybe play action pass, go to the outside guys.
1st and 15, they quick pitch Wide pitch here, but Skarnik knocks Palmer out, and there's good defense, 22 down low.
That's Nathaniel, the defensive halfback, but a good job by number 30, the linebacker. Tom, that's what I was meaning. Get across the line of scrimmage and take on the blockers deep in the backfield. As you've seen, Palmer has a lot of speed
now,
and power.
Number 30 plays outside linebacker, right?
Right.
So how can you make the pitch play work if you don't block him? And there he is, right in the backfield.
Well, it's kind of tough to block someone who gets into the backfield. And you constantly try to remind the outside linebackers to get across the line of scrimmage. On that play, Scarlett did that, and the play went for nothing.
But I had watched Scarlett on the play, and nobody went towards him. And
no one.
I don't think you can make a pitch play work if you can't block the outside linebacker.
There's a nice fake by Cassie. He gets set up. Oh, he's hit. The ball's loose. It's still loose. St. Patel covers it. Oh, Cassie never saw the hit coming. Number 18.
And he's down. Is Cassie ever shaken up? But he really stood his ground in there, and he was just crushed by...
Well, that's 18. That's Kelly, the boy that roughed up Zeltenko on the safety touch. And
that was a good legal tackle on that play, and punishing hit, and Cassie's still down, and they were very fortunate they didn't lose possession of the ball. Good job by one of the offensive linemen, I believe number 66 for St. Patel, leaped on the ball, and that's Milligan. But, you know, let's hope Luigi Cassie isn't too badly hurt. But
I'm just hoping he had a flak jacket on because he was really open to that side for that
shot.
Well,
yeah, I'd say probably some kind of difficulty in the rib area or maybe even a shoulder because his arm was hit in the act of throwing the ball.
That was a good defensive play, and it's going to be third down and half the field to go for a first down. And
I see some gentlemen in the far end zone carrying some trophy wear this way, so...
Perhaps have a bit of an awards at the end of the game. Well, being a championship game, both these teams worked hard to get here. The St. James Rods defeated the Brandon Crocus Plainsmen in the semifinal action last week. And do you have the score there, Tom?
Yeah, I believe somewhere here in my little book of scores. And
well, Luke Cassie's getting off on his own off the field. It's good to see. He's a very nice kid. We had him out at the Maples, out at the Peace Gardens. You can't ask for a nicer young man. And, you know, I'm glad to see he's not too badly shaken up.
Right now, St. Patel needs a big play. Maybe their defense can give him a big play, fellas. I know St. James's defense has sure done the job today. And there's a snap. Zoltenko gets a big rush again. It's blocked again. And it's going to be fielded by Scarlett. If he covers it, he's
no yards.
It's still loose.
Well, there on that play there, Tom, the whistle is blown. It was no yards call against St. Patel. But number 40, Hannah, got his hands up. It's a nightmare for poor Zoltenko. But do you happen to have...
Yeah, I've got some scores from other games. In the Midget semifinals, St. James, we'll just have the replay.
Hannah
here.
Got his hand up again. They really didn't jump very high for it. But I believe we're going to see no yards right there against the St. Patel Mustangs. And the Rods get another big break, Tom.
Anyway, in the games that got both teams into this final, St. James played Brandon in one of the semifinals, and it was 69-15 in favor of St. James. They picked up 385 yards rushing, 7 rushing touchdowns. In the other game, St. Patel beat Fort Garry 31-28. Paul Palmer played a key role in that game. He scored 2 touchdowns. Just to recap the scores of previous games between these two teams, St. James won 43-32. That's a game that Bob and I did out in Westwood. And earlier in the season, St. James defeated St. Patel 34-21.
Well, on that play there, the block punt and the ball being recovered by the St. James Rods, there was no yards on the play, so it's first down for the Rods at the Mustang 35-yard line.
16-0, St. James, and they hope to add to their lead here. The St. James not making a lot of mistakes. Oswald this time slithers through for only about a 2-yard pickup.
Nice tackle on that play by Dalglish.
In the regular season, the St. James Rods were 8 wins, no losses, no ties, 312 points for and only 89 against, whereas St. Patel was in second place at 6-2. They scored 278 points, and they had 146 scored against them. And by far, St. James led both in points scored and fewest points against.
The old Tom Sherbrooke Bible comes out and helps us here, Bob.
That's right. Statistical genius. There's a nice fake by McKay, but he didn't pull 19, but he outruns 19. He's going to pass. Wide open is 73. Oh, what a defensive play. Number is at 28.
28 Miller, the safety, got across and knocked the ball down. But that's good fortune for the Mustangs because number 19 for the Mustangs, that's Jason Lee, lost contain on the quarterback and allowed him to get it outside. And Patrick Jones, the intended receiver, was wide open. His eyes as big as can be, but the ball just didn't get there.
Oh, poor Patrick. You'll be thinking about this one all night.
And there's McKay on the bootleg, and one St. Patel defender wasn't fooled, and we saw the ball knocked down. Great replay there.
Can't fool those safeties sometimes, and a good job by number 28, Wes Miller, to get across and knock the ball down. But another look at the fans, and I'm telling you, it's almost a sold-out place. They had over 2,000 people here last week for the Eastern Canadian Championship Junior game between Ottawa and St. Patel. And today, you know, the stands are packed. I bet we have over 1,000 people here, Tom.
Well, quite a few supporters out here today, and it's good to see that Midget football is attracting this kind of crowd. They have a lot of St. Patel people, as you would expect, and I see a lot of blue and white hats over in this section to our left, and those are the St. James supporters.
Now check all the silverware they're unpacking down in front of us. I think we're going to have some presentations at halftime in this game. Oh, there's a pass going out to it's incomplete regardless.
Well, number seven was in a punter on that play, and that's Stephen Peck. He's their backup quarterback, and the game we did against Crocus Plainsman when the Rods were playing, he came in and really led the Rods in the second half to the victory, and on that play, it was a fake punt all the way, Tom.
Pretty predictable, though, if you're aware of who their normal punter is. That's number 30, Scarlett. And also, if you realize that Peck's a backup quarterback,
right.
It sort of gives one the suggestion they're going for a
punt. But it happens so quick a lot of times, defenses just can't key on it in time, especially at this level.
Well, it looks like St. James going with about a five-man down line there on defense.
There's also a change of quarterback for St. Patel. Number 11, Darren Reeve is in. I believe he was the starter at the beginning of the year. Then he had been moved on out to wideout, and Cassie played quarterback, and now Weave's back in there. And he threw the bomb, I guess you'd call it, and it's incomplete.
Well, last week, Cassie started the game, but Weave was the one who finished it. And here on the replay, we'll see Weave. He's a big kid, stands back there, fires the ball downfield. Intended receiver, I believe, was number 30 or 38, and that was Kinsley Palmer. But he was knocked down by the safety for the St. James Rod, number 22, Nathaniel. But a good, clean play on the play. It'll make it second down and 10 for the Mustangs on their own 35-yard line.
Yeah, we have a second and 10 here. There's a good-looking play for the St. Patel Mustangs. Number 27 just slanting in there. That's Doug Sinclair with the reception.
Okay, well, that was the flanker slant, Bob. Sinclair was lined up wide out on the left, and he just ran a slant in. The inside receiver ran it out. So it's like a crossing pattern, but what do you know? St. Patel penalty.
That was a nice offensive play. Here we see on the replay, number 27 catches the ball, pulled down by 19, Hominuth for the Rods. But every time they have a play that does something, Tom, they seem to do some little thing. On that case, it was a procedure play that calls it back, and that was a change of about 25 yards in possession.
Well, since Weave has been in there, St. Patel has come out throwing the ball, and perhaps it's a change in offensive philosophy here with about 5 minutes left in the first half.
Right now we have a second and 15 for St. Patel. There's Weeb. He wants to throw deep. Getting in position is Palmer, just overthrown by a step there. Well, coverage by number three for St. James. That's Gary Reynolds.
It's obvious that with Weeb in there, they're not afraid to pass the ball. And he's done a good job dropping back, standing there. His offensive line has given him time. He had a man open, just slightly overthrown on that play, Tom.
Well, you're right, Larry. Weeb has come in and he's been throwing the ball. That time he was going for Bob Palmer, I believe another sort of crossing pattern with Palmer on the inside trying to get outside. On the screen there, we have a picture of Bill Dunstone, and I believe he's the Manitoba Midget League president.
Well, okay. You know, with 4 minutes and 30 seconds left in this first quarter,
there's a good driving kick. It goes over Jones's head. Looks like it's coming down. He may as well let it go in the end zone. No, he gets it around the five. He heads upfield. He's got a little room here. Cuts up, lowers his head, and he brings the ball out to the 24-yard line where St. James will take over first and 10.
Tremendous punt by number 95, Zoltenko, and a pretty good return by Jones simply because the ball was so far downfield that the punt coverage team didn't get down there.
Oh, there's some of our crew, I believe, on the right, waving to us.
That could be a rock group in town for LA, I think, who's playing to maybe a Dayton's this week. I'm not sure, but you never know. You know, yeah, these guys love their football.
A rock group, could be just fans. It could be anybody.
And you guys, of course, know that rock and roll revival is coming to Winnipeg. But here goes Ogwall with the ball. He looked at him, lower his shoulder, and keep going for a first down on the play. Nice run.
And Ogwall had to sort of secure the ball on the run there because he was fumbling around with it. Tacklers were approaching, and he did a good job holding on and lowering his shoulder.
What nice blocks downfield by the men around the corner there. Just great. They just knocked the St. Paul Mustangs down. 28 Miller was the last man to safety and knocked him out of bounds.
Well, I'm really impressed with this little pitch play that St. James has been running so effectively. And they get the tackle out there blocking and the other running back, and it's really working nicely.
It reminded me of my first year high school coaching at Grant Park. Same color uniforms. We had Gord Patterson. Gord left, Gord right, we called it. There's number 38 wide open. Another first down for St. James with the reception. There is David Newberry.
Newberry. Option pass. We see the quarterback pitch out to Ogwald, and of course the pitch that St. James runs sets that play up, and Ogwald just threw downfield. Here we're going to see the quarterback pitch out to Ogwald, and he's going to look for Newberry 38 running a little out pattern.
That was such a nicely set up play. It wasn't long or delayed. It was just went for a 10-yard gain. Usually a pitch pass, they want to go for the whole bundle, score a touchdown. But not
first
there.
Down, St. James. Here's a nice looking play. They give it to Jones. Look at that play. Oh, Cobb, you'll drool on this replay.
Well, once again,
how meriless is hope you don't drool.
Excuse me while I wipe the drool from my face. But no, that was set up by the pitch play. And once again, they faked the pitch, and they had the wing back doing the wide belly motion, and then he cut it upfield, and Dubeski threw a beautiful block. That was Patrick Jones, the ball carrier, and we're going to see it again. And there it is, Jones turning it up, and lots of running room there, and it's all set up on the pitch. They've been making the play work.
3 minutes left in this first half. Score 16-0 for the Rods over the Mustangs.
You know, the Rods can do no wrong in this first half. There they give again to Ogwall. He keeps driving. He's gone. Number 17 will never catch him.
They won't catch him.
Whoa.
What a nice play.
St. James, do you believe it?
Did he have a hole up the middle, Tom? Broke it to the outside. No one could catch him.
Well, it was an eye formation off tackle. Believe that they went to the left. Ogwald glanced right, saw some open space, and veered right, and he's in the end zone.
44-yard touchdown run, Tom.
44 yards.
Here's the replay.
I'm going to see it again. Now, it's just a straight handoff. They're going inside, and Ogwald decides to turn it outside to the right. There he goes. He's gets the ball to the outside, and he's over.
Just so glides in there, not really pushing himself too hard. What a running back.
And Martin punches the cover through.
That makes the score right now 23 for the St. James Rods, 0 for the Mustangs. And really, it's been all Rods this whole first half.
It looks like the Mustangs are going to have to just ride out this first half, win and regroup, and try and keep the score what it is.
Yep.
And maybe even if they get 3 points or touchdown themselves, get some momentum back.
Well, St. James has got 3 touchdowns on the board so far. Margulies recovering a blocked punt by Kelly. Ogwald on a pitch left. And Ogwald, we saw him there running off tackle, veering outside to the right. 3 converts by Martin and a safety touch makes it 23-0 in favor of St. James.
We better not have Tom drooling too much. It seems he's always spilling coffee on his headsets and whatever. Now it's the drool. Al Merrilis, our sound man, just every time Tom comes by, Al just sort of shakes and says, oh no, more equipment gone.
Well, I get my pants wet one way or the other, whether it's drool or
there's
coffee
Martin's
or whatever.
Pick is probably going to go to battle.
And what else, Tom?
And let's see, the Rods will have to kick off with a 5-yard penalty assess.
You know what would be nice is waterproof pants supplied by VPW for the announcers. What do you think?
Well, at least for one announcer, right, Bob?
Coming up next week, you viewers, we hope you'll tune in on Sunday morning to catch the Bantam League Championship between Transcona and St. Patel. And also, we've got a 13-year-old Waffle Championship game for you, too. That's going to feature the River Heights Cardinals, and I believe St. Patel Mustangs have even qualified in that age category also.
Boy,
that's coming up next Sunday morning for you.
Mustangs organization, from the smallest kid to the oldest, they sure are a powerhouse.
You know, they'll be hoping that this isn't a sort of a disease their teams are catching in these championship games, though, the way this game has been a nightmare for St. Patel. 57 covered the ball there. I guess that's Carlson for St. Patel.
Yep, Carlson.
He'll take over right there.
Carlson's a big linebacker, grabbed the hold of the ball, lost his footing, went down. The ball's on the 35-yard line of the Mustangs with only 2 minutes and 40 seconds left in this first half.
Well, I don't see number 2, Lou Cassie, out there, but I do see number 11, Weeb, so it looks like he's staying in at quarterback. And with, as you say, Larry, about 2 minutes and 40 seconds left, I'm betting they're going to go long. They're down 23-0.
They better go long. They better start getting some points on the board.
There's Weeby. He angles it out to 27. Sinclair incomplete. Good coverage by number 19 for St. James. That's Mitch Humminick.
What? Not a very good, well-timed pattern, Tom. It seems like he threw the ball earlier than he should have.
Well, I was just thinking that perhaps if he pump fakes and then drops back a little deeper and lets the receiver run straight downfield, they're going to work something with that.
Yep, quite possibly. But they really don't have time to try to establish a running game. They haven't had much success in almost two quarters of play, and the pass can be there.
There's Weave. He gets good pressure. Brought down from behind on nice play by Scarlett, the corner linebacker on the side of the field, and we got a flag, a late flag.
Might be intentional grounding because number 11 Weave threw the ball.
Did he?
Yes.
Well, blitzing was coming very hard from the outside linebackers, number 30 Scarlett, number 18 Kelly. Weave did a good job eluding Kelly, number 18, for the first man through on him. Kept running, but he was caught from behind by Scarlett. The flag is down, and we'll see what the official calls. The
flag dropped an error.
Yeah, flag dropped an error, according to the officials, and looks like we'll see St. Patel punting away. Plenty of time for the Rods to come back and get another score, Tom.
And I just wanted to say that number 30, Scarlett, made the tackle on the quarterback, and he came from the right outside all the way over to the other side of the field.
He also had help from number 57, the middle linebacker, Jason Rawhaus, who also was in on the tackle, but
yeah, we haven't called his name. We haven't called Jason's name a lot in this game, but you just know he's out there flying around with this kind of score.
Oh,
there's
no.
A bad snap. Oh, what a nightmarish first half this has been for St. Patel. And do you believe that kick?
Look at the punt.
Jones takes a slip. He should be whistled down right there on the 35-yard line.
Jones has had some problem with his footing today. That's the second time he's gone down with the knee hitting the ground. And what a job Zaltenko did getting the punt off and turned it into a pretty nice kick.
Yeah, that was a very lucky that the St. James Rods were setting up a return on that play. They weren't going for the block because no one was really rushing in there. And Zaltenko turned. He had plenty of time to get rid of the punt. Kicked it right for the sidelines, and he got that nice St. Patel roll and brought it deep in Rod territory on their own 35-yard line.
There we just had seen the score for the second quarter here. It's 23-0 in favor of St. James.
Here's McKay, a nice little fake, but he's getting all kind of pressure. We'll see if he can get away from it. He does so far, but the receivers aren't helping him too much. Ogwall wasn't even looking for the ball.
Well, that was the problem. McKay rolled out, and there no receivers were turning around and looking back.
Well, did you see McKay? He's running for his life. The whole defensive line for the Mustangs, Morton, Schwarik, Kozlowski, and Bonnie were on him, and he was lucky to get outside.
One of his linemen came back to help him out, and he made a pretty fine block. It might have been Dubeski.
Look at McKay. Linemen.
Nobody's looking at him, except linemen, and they can't catch the ball. Not because they physically can't, but because they're not allowed to, according to the rules of the game.
Right, Merrithew, a linebacker, was in on that play, too.
Our handheld cameraman, Manfred Nikhil, almost caught that ball there with his left hand. A routine play
Manfred's
for him.
Manfred's so ambidextrous with right hand, left hand. In fact, he even stands on his head sometimes to get us some shots.
Yeah, great camera work, fellas. I think we got Brad Holloway up above us on the play-by-play camera. Here's
reverse.
The reverse. It's number, 38 with the ball there. It's a
Newberry
play.
And you know what? Quarterback McKay, number 5, actually threw a block. He tried to take down number 66, a big defensive lineman for...
and he's still down on one knee. Don't play with those big linemen.
Oh, geez. I wonder if we'll get to see it again. It was some kind of reverse action, and Newberry ended up carrying the ball going from right to left. And he got 7 yards.
You know, I like the imagination shown by St. James on their attack today.
Oh, there's been a lot of trick plays, reverse, a couple of option passes they've tried.
But I mean, they're executing them. They're not beating themselves.
But when it comes right down to it, the basic things like the pitch, they're just doing that so well. I mean, that's probably enough to...
We'll see if Scarlett does a little better job here, dropping the ball this time. No, he doesn't. Another poor kick for St. James. Let's see, St. Patel's going to take over probably right around midfield there, and Scarlett just not concentrating and dropping the ball properly.
Speaking of midfield, there is a flag on the play. Right dropped at midfield. And there we see some of the lovely women in attendance at today's game, cheering on their boyfriends, or perhaps their fathers coach the teams.
Or brothers.
Perhaps they're here to see the broadcast announcers.
Not likely.
This is
well, how about the cameraman? How about McGregor?
Yeah, probably the producer, Jim McGregor, with all that extra money he's gotten lately. You know, he's a man about town. But the penalty was against St. Patel, and the Rods get the ball again. And first down, did you find what that was?
Too many men on the field. That's twice that's happened, I think, Larry.
That's happened before. So St. James is coming out over the ball, and a minute and a half left.
McKay has been very cool at quarterback today. He just runs all kinds of pressure.
Receivers are looking at him again.
He's going to turn up. Oh, watch this. Oh, if that play had been another yard sort of into the field.
Smart play by McKay. He ran for his life. He was chased by Morton. He was chased by Russo, and he just got him.
That time, McKay rolled out. A receiver actually looked at him, number 73.
No.
And when 73 saw that McKay was in trouble, he looked away from him.
There's McKay running for his life.
Hey, fellas, watch how he hurdles.
There's
our parabolic microphone on the ground here. He hurdles our mic. There it is.
Oh. And he actually ends up getting a first row seat.
And Al Marylis, his heart's just pounding in the truck.
Oh,
Second quick pitch to Oswald. He gets a good little rush kind of block, gets it outside. First down, St. James.
Larry, did you see the block by number 32, Schwab, on the outside man? And a beautiful cut by Oswald, taking it inside and then back outside. And we'll see it again on the replay.
Well, no, I'm telling you, that was a very nice run by Oswald. Another first down. They're really marching. There's a minute and 19 seconds left. They've got both their timeouts still if they have to use them, Tom.
I'll tell you, it was a great block by Schwab and also a good piece of running in terms of making cuts by number 24, Oswald.
Well, St. Pell's made some defensive changes there, and players running on and off the field.
I think the official just gave St. Patel another break there with a legal substitution. Again, what a nightmare for St. Patel. His first half has been. And Schwab, the big back, just lowers his shoulder, goes for about 4 yards in the play. There's a shot of all the players in piling there.
Soft tackle play. St. James running it to their right. That would be behind Christian, the right guard, and Lezick, the right tackle. Should mention Martin's in at end, and so is Swan, number 76.
Well, we got a timeout called by the St. James Rods with 47 seconds left in this half. They probably want to get close enough to at least try a field goal attempt or possibly get another 6 points. If they do, Tom, St. Patel has a real uphill battle in the second half.
Oh, they certainly do, because a touchdown would make it 30-0 at the half. But, you know, I'm really amazed thinking back a couple of plays ago when McKay was rolling out and the receiver looked at him until he could see that he was in extreme amount of difficulty, and then he looked away from him. Like, let's see what you can
do, Chad. Can do, buddy. Yeah. And then when he stepped out of bounds, he stepped right in front of all the St. Patel fans, and they're screaming, sissy, sissy. Yeah. Like, I don't see anyone in their right mind trying to lower their shoulder. He had two linebackers just barreling down
on him. And no technical equipment broken. That was amazing.
You know, I'm really impressed with McKay so far, and I was impressed. That's what I saw him 2 weeks ago at Westwood. Here's the reverse. Back to the quarterback. I think it is going to be a pass.
And look who's wide open.
No, they can't get the ball to him.
What a good play.
Number 73 was wide open for St. James, and that was a Daryl Martin. He was standing about on the 10-yard line. Nobody around.
What would you call that? A double reverse pitch back to the quarterback, throw down field?
Something like that.
Coach Rojas offside against digging back into the Bombers playbook of Kenny Plains days.
And McKay's going to get the ball. He's going to throw downfield, and he has a man wide open. Just a bad pass, though.
Yeah, he was being rushed by that point, but what a play.
I think it was intended for 73, Daryl Martin, and yet Patrick Jones, number 27, made a diving attempt.
But St. Patel was offside on the play, so we have a second and one here, and St. Patel does their best here to keep St. James rolling along. Second and one?
Second and one.
Passing situation over the middle, wide open. A nice play to the tight end, 73. Martin, look at that kid run. Where's he been all game? Down to the 1 yard line.
Oh, what a nice play.
Well, it was just basically a little look-in pass, I think you'd call it. And Martin was lined up on the left. He just sort of slanted in over the middle. I think the linebackers had shot for St. Patel, and there was lots of space there.
Well, he got right in that open area where the linebackers vacated, especially Russo, number 82, Dalglish, and Carlson. He caught the ball, turned it straight upfield, did a good job getting it down to the 1 yard line. Too bad the kid couldn't put it in after all that work.
The pursuit there, the way he was hot putting it through there. A great effort there by the receiver in that play, Martin. There's a flag on the play. They give inside to the big back. Touchdown, St. James. We'll wait to see what the flag is.
Well, the flag is down, and we'll have to see it. Quite possibly could be offside against the Mustangs. Offside Mustangs. It's declined there on the replay. We could see back just sort of skips in from 1 yard out. Another 6 points with the convert will make the score.
30-0.
Oh, boy. 8 seconds left in the first half. This first half's been all blue, all St. James Rods. Well, The fans are just going crazy for the St. James Rods. They're hooting and hollering. There's not much cheering coming from the St. Patel supporters.
There's Martin with the convert. He just used a wedge to get that one through, but he got it through.
And the score is 30-0 for the Rods over the Mustangs. And
we have about 8 seconds here to halftime.
Well, perhaps we'll see some kind of double reverse, pitch back, sidearm, underhanded return for the Mustangs. They got to do something, Tom.
Well, four St. James touchdowns here in the first half. Margulies on the block punt. Ogwald on, two running plays. One was a pitch left and the other was off tackle, and he veered it right for 44 yards. Schwab off tackle right gets the fourth St. James touchdown. Four converts by Martin and a safety touch. Makes
actually,
it 30-0.
Maybe alert our technical people, if they wanted to break away at this time, would be fine. Maybe give some of our cameramen a little more time to rest there at halftime and some of the other people.
There's number five. That's Chad McKay, the quarterback for the St. James Rods. And we've seen him do some pretty frantic running today.
Wouldn't that be something? We get a return for a touchdown.
There's the short kick.
St. James going for the bundle, going for the short kick.
I think they got it covered, too.
The Rods can do no wrong.
I believe it was number 73, Martin, kicked the ball and then just trailed after it.
Yep.
He kicked it right in between two people in the first wall of the St. Patel KOR.
I don't think it was really intended as a short kickoff. I could bet Coach Rawhouse told him not to pound it deep, and he put a little squibber on there, and they caught the St. Patel Mustangs by surprise. They take over the ball at the 50-yard line of the Mustangs with just 6 seconds left in this half, and there's a happy Rod supporter.
And he's got some kind of placard that he's carrying there, something about the Hog Squad.
There's an incomplete pass, and that time should run out. I think it's halftime here.
I really hope we get a view of that placard that fan's carrying, maybe later in the second half.
Yeah, right now we're going to break for about 15 minutes here at St. Patel Memorial Park. It's halftime in this Midget Championship game. The Rods have jumped out 30-0. Fellas, we're not taking microphones in that St. Patel locker room at halftime today. We'll see you shortly. Back to the first quarter of this championship major football game. It was all St. James in the first half. They lead the St. Patel Mustangs 30-0. Larry, maybe we'll let this first play run through here, and you could mention to some of our viewers some of the halftime presentations that went on.
Sure, they had all-star presentations at halftime, their MVP awards, coaches awards, and whatever for the Midget League. The MVP for the Midget League was Dave Bryant from Crocus Plains, and a fine running back. Most sportsmanlike with leadership ability award went to Roger Phillip of Transcona. Most outstanding lineman went to Andy Lessick of St. James Rods right here. The coaching staff here was this St. James Rods coaching staff. Head coach of Norm Rawhouse, assistant coach Ben Langus, Gord Rowan, Paul Decker, Bob Sansom. And the scoring champion was Dave Bryant, also the Crocus Plainsman, had 84 points with 14 touchdowns. And Bob, on the play there?
Well, you know, it was just a quick pitch to Kensley Palmer. The ball bounced off his chest. St. James fell on the ball. Do you believe it?
It's all St. James this whole game. The score 30-0 for the St. James Rods over the Mustangs. Tom Sherbrooke hasn't made his way back to the booth yet. Sort of a bit of a break for us, too.
First down, St. James McKay, a quarterback. He gives to the second man. Ogwald takes it outside. He's got makes a nice turn down the corner. And probably about a 15-yard pickup. Should be first down for St. James.
Well, Ogwald did a good job. He got the ball, got a couple of blocks initially at the line of scrimmage, broke to the outside, skipped down the sidelines, got around the 15-yard line. There's a look at young Ogwald, one of the finer running backs in the league. But back to those halftime presentations, Bob. We've seen a lot of all-stars. I believe each team was allowed 5 all-stars, which is a nice touch. Here on the replay, we see ball given to Ogwell. He breaks the outside, breaks a couple of tackles, keeps running, and gets down the sideline, eventually pushed out of bounds. And believe it or not, Tom has made it back.
There goes Pat Jones to the wide side, but he just gets a nice pick block there. 82 tries to get him. He turns it off. Touchdown, St. James, and the Rods are on the march again.
Nice job by Patrick Jones, number 27. He got this play, just a mirror play of what Ogwell's was to the right. Patrick Jones went to the left, got a couple of nice blocks by his lead backer and a couple of linemen pulling. We'll see on the replay a nice block by number 52, Dubetsky. Number 24, Ogwell throws a little bit of a block, just enough to get Jones into the end zone. And it starts off all St. James Rods. Another touchdown by Patrick Jones, making the score 36-0 with the convert to come. And it's up and it's good. And that makes the score 37-0. The Rods over these poor Mustangs. And really, we were talking at halftime, Bob, when Tom deserted us. And we were, mentioned that, perhaps St. Patel has to come out a little more fired up for this second half. They sure didn't. And you made a good comment, too. The two quarterbacks are warming up. That would be number 11 for the Mustangs, Darren Weeb, and number 2, Lou Cassie. And they're throwing the ball, and you said with the luck that the St. Patel Mustangs have had today, the quarterback will dislocate his thumb in that warm-up. But it certainly hasn't been very much fun for these Mustangs. Tom, are you back, able to talk?
I'm back, and I'm able to talk, but you're making some fine comments there, so I thought I'd just listen as the viewers are. And at halftime, I was talking to some of my friends and colleagues in the coaching profession here at getting their views of the game.
Oh, there's a loose ball, and St. James has it once again, a wedge shot in the kickoff.
That was a wedge shot the lineman had as he was hit by his own man. It bounced loose, and number 50 for the Rods. And that's Daryl Parisian, was right on the spot to grab the ball. What else could go wrong for these Mustangs?
Well,
they certainly
are self-destructing. As you called it, one of the linemen dropped the ball. Parisian was there to recover for St. James, and another offensive series for St. James in St. Patel territory.
McKay remains the quarterback, a little hand fake. He passes to a wide-open Greg Steinhubel, and Greg, touchdown.
Yep.
And he'll have an 8-yard pickup.
Well, Steinhubel is going to be very close to the first down. He caught the ball very close to the sidelines, and I believe it was one of these clear out the flat and then send one receiver into the flat.
Well, the Rods, they aren't going to just sort of roll over and say, we got the game in hand right now. They want to add another, at least another touchdown on to show that it wasn't just a first half fluke. They want to, build on to their lead. That's the kind of team that the Rods have. They got a lot of depth. And we're bound to see everyone on their bench on the team, on the field today. And
we should probably see their other quarterback in there as well, Stephen Peck, eventually, number 7.
Yeah, not losing much.
Second and long, too. There's a runner into the game there for St. James.
I think that's number 20, Barry Cluner.
Good job by Morton, the defensive end, number 76 on the play. Got across the line of scrimmage, made the tackle, making it a third down about 3 yards ago. Tom, at halftime, remember we had a bit of comment, like, why are all these pretty-looking girls here? Are they here to see the players or the coaches or even the producers? We're all wrong. You know who they're here to see?
Who's that?
Coogie Bear. He had a whole group of girls around him at halftime. It was incredible.
Oh, maybe he can introduce us to a few of them.
I don't know. Like, Coogie Bear was chasing me. Gary Coughlin. He was chasing me away, huh? I don't know. Like, I think, we created a monster, Tom. We made him into a sex symbol. Now, all the girls from around Winnipeg will flock to the games from now on just to see Coogie. And there's getting off the field on his own steam as the player who made the tackle, number 76, Morton. It's good to see that he's all right. Big lineman, good job he's done today.
Is this Coogie Bear? Is this Bear B-A-R-E Bear or B-E-A-R Bear?
I think it goes both ways.
Here goes Ogwell to the outside. First down territory. He cuts up. Number 17 has position, but Ogwell just gets inside of a 75. Saved a touchdown from St. Patel with a nice tackle. That's Todd Dagley.
Well, once again, that's Ogwald running the ball for St. James, and they got to the outside again. Ogwald saw some daylight. He turned it upfield. Great blocking by the backs and the offensive line. Here we see it. Soft tackle plays following Schwab, number 32. Whoa, what a collision we saw there. And Ogwald sort of swims by one tackler, and St. James first down. They're knocking at the door again.
It's a nightmare for the Mustangs.
There they get Ogwell. This time he slithers through somehow. I think he's in the end zone. Touchdown, St. James.
Well, the heart is taken right out of the St. Patel Mustangs defense. They had a couple of shots at him. No one really wrapped up or put a hit on. When you're down by over 40 points, it's kind of tough to get up for the game. And, it's only 3 minutes gone in this second half. There's a lot of time left.
Now, we can see that St. Patel's not wrapping up. Ogwell's just bouncing off of people.
Hearts are gone. And And he just sort of skipped into the end zone for the touchdown.
And there's number 24, Ogwald. He's got some interesting, he's got an interesting headwear on there.
Yeah, it helps the old helmet fit a little better.
Oh,
there.
I see.
Yeah.
And that would be his third touchdown.
Bob used to wear those in his days.
He did he?
Yeah. I've been known to grow my hair pretty long. This is, oh, there's another shank right through for Saint James.
Well, Martin has a very interesting style of kicking.
He makes it exciting for the viewers. He puts it just over the hands of the lineman coming in and just over the bar, and or else he chips it up high, so you have the suspense of watching it come down.
Well, the score was 30-0 at halftime. I believe St. Patel had one or two offensive plays. Then they've turned the ball over two times to St. James. They've scored both times they've had the ball. It's 44-0.
Well, St. Patel, they had the ball at their own 35-yard line, a handoff given to Palmer. It went off his chest, down it went. And there's a nice sign, Rod's revenge. I guess all those years of the Winnipeg Rods junior team, losing. It's good to see that they got a midget program, and even their bantam program is really chugging along, and eventually those boys will go to the Rods, the big Rods.
That's a sign they could say for next year's Manitoba junior final. If Rod outweighs the coach and St. Patel wins, then it's Rod's revenge.
Rod's revenge.
St. Patel's going to take over. It looks to be around their, let's see, their 27-yard line.
Well, it's we see number 11, Weave, going back into the game for the St. Patel Mustangs. He took over from a shaken-up Lou Cassie, number 2 for the St. Patel Mustangs, who took a vicious hit by number 18, Kelly, at near the end of the second quarter. And really, the St. Patel, they have a long way to go to get back into this game.
Well, the first thing they have to do is just hold on to the ball and be able to march it downfield, not turn it over. They can't afford any more turnovers.
This is an interesting alignment. It looks like about a 5-7 defense St. James is using here. There's Scarlett putting pressure on Weave. Weave is getting hit from the Rawhouse, and he's knocked out of bounds.
Rawhouse, good job by Rawhouse, the middle linebacker, getting across the line, keeping up with a kid like Weave. Weave's a good athlete. Scarlett missed his contain on the outside, number 3, the outside linebacker, and Weave was pounded out of bounds.
Is that Jonathan Winters in the stands there? Okay, and here we're going to see Weave rolling out. He's got a receiver in front of him here in the flat, and can't throw the ball and just has to run out of bounds with it.
And there's Rawhouse helping him out of bounds, but not after about a 5-yard gain.
Second and 4 for St. Patel. Weave back to pass. He swings it out behind Palmer. It looked like a poorly thrown ball.
A nice coverage there by Reynolds, number 3, the defensive halfback. He was right on Palmer. There was really no chance for the ball to be completed. It'll make it third down and about 5 to go for a first down. I'm very surprised to see the punting team go on there.
Third and 4 coming up here for St. Patel.
Well, something's making the fans pretty wild here, and we're not really sure what it is. Tom, do you happen to catch what's going on?
Well, apparently the two sets of fans are becoming verbally, they're having a verbal joust, you might say.
Here's Altenko. Gets good pressure again. No roughing. He shanked the kick. Again, St. James will have the ball in midfield. No yards. Penalty against St. Patel.
What
St.
else
James
is new?
Will actually take over down in the St. Patel 40.
Well, everything's been going against St. Patel. When the flag goes down, what else?
I wish Bob Scobar was here doing the stats, and maybe we could get a penalty rundown on how many penalties St. Patel has had, because it seems like everyone's against them.
That's right. And there's another 15-yarder marched off, bringing the ball well into the St. Patel Mustangs end. The ball's going to be placed down at the 51-yard line of the Mustangs. Rods, I guess you call it knocking on the door.
Could the Mustangs come up with 7 touchdowns here in the time remaining? They'd have to get a little help from the defense.
Remember, Bob, in the semis, they scored 69 points against Brandon, so they're capable of running scores up into the 60s and 70s.
Yeah, those Rods, they sure can put points on the board.
First down, there's that number 20 again. Look at that kid step through there. Oh, no!
Oh, yeah.
No, 17's got him. Touchdown, St. James!
When we did the game against Crocus Plains, they put that little number 20.
That's Barry Cooner.
Barry Cooner into the game. 3 rushes, Tom. 114 yards.
Oh.
And he's a backup.
Whoa. What bench strength.
What bench strength.
And we're going to stare as Cooner again. It's off tackle. He veers outside. One tackler misses him. He's got lots of blockers downfield, and he just gets in right at the very corner there where that little marker was, the orange marker.
What a nice touchdown by Kluter as Bob Whitlaw and I clunk heads in celebration.
The convert is this.
There is an interesting convert attempt.
Makes it a nice round 50.
And the score.
I'd like to apologize to all our viewers east of the Red River. Any resemblance between this St. Vital team and the team we've seen all year is beyond me.
Now, St. Vital's had a good year. They were 6-2, and they were considered one of the premium teams here in the Midget League. I guess the only to be outdone by St. James. And
right.
It's 50-0, but... And we hear the fan. You can probably hear the fans here in the background calling out to each other.
That's right. Well, we're going to see the St. James Rod kick off again. And, well, what else could go wrong with the Mustangs attack? The score, 50-0. The Rod's over the Mustangs. 10 minutes left in this third quarter.
Oh, Jay, there's a hex on St. Vital. Somebody put a hex on the Mustangs. They bring the ball out. Steve James mishandles the kick, brings it out to the 40-yard line. First down, St. Vital.
I'm speechless, Paul.
Well, I'm not. I'm going to mention the St. James Rod's coaches. Their head coach is Norm Rawhouse. The running back coach is Gordy Rowland. Defensive coaches are Ben Langhams, and I know Al Hayes has been helping out. Defensive line coach is Bob Sanson, and the offensive line coach is Paul Decker.
Well, you know, if you would have been here at the start of the second half, we would have mentioned that they were the outstanding coaching staff in the Midget League. Now, we've got a few all-stars. If we get a chance, we'll try to mention their names.
Well, one other thing. The manager for the St. James Rods is Brian Schwab.
Louis Cassie, back at quarterback.
There's a pass. He's under throw. Intercepted by St. James, number 19, I believe.
Mitch Hominook, who had man coverage on the wide receiver.
Also a flag on the play.
That's Mitch Hominook with interception.
Now, I think Cassie threw the ball, and it was
Cassie
intended
threw the ball.
For number 11, Darren Weave, the other quarterback. It was short.
Cassie also got crunched on that play. I believe that's what the flag is about, roughing the passer.
And Cassie drops back. He looks downfield. He's looking for number 11. And
just underthrowing.
You can see it's underthrown, as
well,
Larry called it.
If I can mention a few of the all-stars here, for the Fort Garry Lions, they had Mike Nylas, a wide receiver, Will Wadowich, running back, David Bevins, a guard, Al Hanslip, a D-back, Austin Harvey, a linebacker, and Mark Granitio, a linebacker.
Fellas,
the Crocus Plainsman from Brandon's All-Stars. Mark Henson, the quarterback. Dave Bryant, fullback. Brad Hardy, the center. Danny Scott, the safety. Mike Gillis, the linebacker. Dean Poets, another linebacker. And don't tell me.
Rough play penalty. Who do you think it was called on?
Mustangs.
First down, St. James.
What else could happen?
They're on the 35-yard line of the Mustangs. And
this reminded me of a basketball game I saw a few years ago on TV where that Kreskin, the great Kreskin, hypnotized both teams and they couldn't score. I think
really?
In tonight's game he's hypnotized St. Vital. He put a hex on it.
Well, if I get back to the All-Stars, Lockport Cowboys All-Stars are Bill Johnson, a wide receiver, Brian Miller, a running back, Greg Fatoma, a guard, Chris DeBrot, a safety, Curtis Kube, a linebacker, and Trent LeFerrick, a defensive end. And we'll get on with some more later on, Tom.
Okay, second down for St. James. They've got Kluner in the backfield. He's number 20. And it looks like they've got a shotgun here.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a bit of a high snap and a pass over the middle. 76 had a chance for the reception there. We felt it complete. That's ANDREW SWAN.
There's a flag on the play, Tom.
There is a flag.
Bets on who it's against.
Oh.
Procedure against the Rods. That's an odd one.
Procedure.
But on that replay, Tom, the receiver's right in between the linebackers and the D-backs. Nice place for the stop. Here's the replay.
Okay, and there's number 5, McKay, getting the high snap. And it was intended for 76, Swan, incomplete.
Well, some more all-stars we got for the Transco Nationals. Wes Mueller, quarterback. Offensive tackles, Richard Fraze and Owen Williams. Safety, David Warbick, Brent Reed, a D-back, and Roger Phillip, a defensive tackle.
There's Charlotte Hunt is taken by Palmer. He reverses it, I think, to Weisner, but St. St. James team not fooled, and St. Vitale's going to take over about their own 13-yard line.
A real nice job by the St. James number three, Gary Reynolds, a defensive halfback, and a containment on that play. He stayed deep on his side of the field. The reverse came his way. He was right there to make the play.
You know, Larry, this is the championship weekend, I believe, here at St. Vitale, and many of the final games of a number of the football leagues here in Winnipeg are being played today. 9 o'clock this very morning, the Waffle 10-year-old final was played, and the Transcona Nationals went up against the Greendale Falcons. The Nationals were the winners. They scored a 38-8 victory, and number 42, Keith Riddick, scored 6 touchdowns today for them.
Oh, where's what area of town is that?
That's Transcona, and that's pretty close to Sisler.
There's a completed pass. The receiver caught the pass. He flipped it up in the air for some reason, and a big lineman, number 65 for the Mustangs, Brent Kaniski, did a good job getting across the jump on it, but that was an odd play, Tom. Perhaps we get a replay of this.
Well, Larry, I'm just sort of looking over the schedule for the championship weekend, and the Waffle 10-year-old final was played today. We just mentioned that. There was also a Bantam consolation. And, of course, today we've got the midget final.
Oh, there's
final.
A nice long pass. Weeb, the receiver, what a play. That's probably the
a nice pass by Cassie to Weeb, but what a 50-yard pass play. The quarterback deep in his own end, threw the ball down, and there's a bit of pushing and shoving around the goalpost areas, and really, Cassie did a good job. Dropped back there, threw the ball downfield right to Darren Weeb, the backup quarterback who pulled the ball in for a long gain.
Anyway, getting back to the Bantam consolation, the Eastside Eagles scored a 15-1 victory over the Lockport Cowboys. Touchdowns today for Eastside were scored by Sam Varani and also Wade Dietzik. Here we have the midget final tomorrow, being Sunday, November the 3rd. Today then will be the Waffle 11-year-old final and the 13-year-old final and, of course, the Bantam championship.
Just in case some of our viewers wake up and think they're in a time warp, they slept for a week and it was Saturday again.
There's a pass by Cassie, a little high intended for Palmer.
Perhaps I can mention the St. Boniface Warriors All-Stars. They have wide receiver Jeff Plett, an offensive guard Jeff Williamson, and Mike Leslie, linebacker Mike Moore, Matt Claverkamp, a defensive end, and here's a favorite of ours, Fitzroy Hyatt, a defensive end, a Sisler Spartan, a former Sisler Spartan player, and nice kid. It's good to see he made the All-Star team for the Manitoba Midget Football League.
There's Lou Cassie again, same play, Palmer's open, if he can get by number three, he'll go, St. Patel, 50 on the scoreboard here, knocked out of bounds, probably around the 5 or 6 yard line.
What a nice play, pass and run play, just a slip tackle by poor number three, Reynolds.
Well, it was Ball Palmer out in the flat, number 36, Darrell Johnson, was able to catch him almost at the goal line. I hope we get to see it again on the replay, and there's some more of Cookie Bears fans.
They must have got some donuts in.
But St. Vitale.
I didn't say that, Coogie Bob did.
St. Vitale, first down within the 5 yard line, I believe, and this is the best or the closest they've got to the goal line today.
There's the play to Palmer. Oh, St. James, tough in between tackles.
Nothing there. Good job by the defensive line of the Rod. That's Margulies, Turner, Schneider, Hannah, and Larrigan. Just stack it up, the offensive linemen of the St. Vitale Mustangs. This is kind of exciting. We're getting to see the Mustangs play like we know they can play.
And I believe time out here for the Mustangs. Oh, no, I guess not. Weeb came out and 27 went in. Okay.
Well, Cassie's still at quarterback, number two for the Mustangs. Second down, goal from the three.
Looks like you're right, Larry. I was watching that downs marker to the far side, and I think he called it there. There's Palmer. He cuts inside, and he was close. I thought he was in the end zone, but no way.
There's a flag flying.
Yes.
Rather late. Did you see what
there were? Two football players on the right side of the field. Number 80 for St. Vitale and whoever was covering on the corner for St. James.
St. James called the rough play, Paul.
Okay. Well, they were having some kind of disagreement, I suppose, and there was some rough play.
Well, the ball's moved half the distance to the goal line, so it should be around the 1 yard line. St. Vitale, 3 cracks with a back like Palmer. We're bound to see him just vault himself into the end zone. Well, it's been an interesting second half. It's been all St. James Rods up to this last little drive where the Mustangs have gotten a couple of quick completions, a good pass and run plays, went from their own 3 yard line down to the 1 yard line of the Rods.
Let's see what the Mustangs can come up with here. Cassie's in a quarterback. He gives to the second man, Palmer. But
there's somebody
submarine there for St. James. Did a terrific job in the middle.
Mishandling on the play, Bob. There was a fumble. The quarterback, Cassie, had handed off to Palmer.
And there's no indication who has the ball yet. Both teams are jumping around. But it looks like St. Patel will retain possession of it.
Actually, the longer it takes St. Patel to score here, the better it is for St. James, that's for sure.
Well, with 4 minutes and 40 seconds left in this third quarter and time running, the score 50 for the St. James Rods and no score for the St. Patel Mustangs.
There, the quarterback, I think, just kept the ball in that play straight ahead.
Look at what's happening in the end zone there, Larry. 85 Palmer. Blocking rather aggressively St. James defender.
Well, no touchdown there. Good job by the defensive line again. Like, this is a lot of cracks here, and it looks like the coach for Jim Ladd for the St. Patel Mustangs calling a timeout. But, Tom, inside the five-yard line, that's the fourth attempt they had at going up the middle, and they still haven't scored. And that's good defense by those Rods.
Good defense, but they might want to play action in, an inside running play, maybe hit somebody in the flat.
Not for 1 yard out. You shouldn't have to play action. Your line should get something, but it's hard to believe
they're not. shouldn't they do something different?
Well, that certainly would be different.
Okay. Yeah.
There we see Cassie. He goes behind his offensive lineman. They just didn't get enough charge on the play. And the big defensive line, I'll mention them again. They've done such a good job of Margulies, Turner, Schneider, Hannah, Larrigan, backed up by the linebackers of Rawhouse, Scarlett, Kelly, defensive backs Reynolds and Nathaniel, and quarterback Steinhubel and Johnson. They've really stood tall on this defensive stand against these St. Patel Mustangs. Well, with 4 minutes, about 18 seconds left, we see Lou Cassie going back on the field, and the play has been blown in, so he's going to have to get off in a hurry.
I think that they should play action pass, or they should fake inside and go outside with it.
Well, I'd go straight up the middle and then glare at the linemen if they don't get you a yard.
Well, you'd go straight up the middle, and then you'd call your defense on the field because it'd be St. James first down.
Here's the play. We've got a good look at this. We'll watch the quarterback. Oh, there's some early motion, but they give the ball to James.
It didn't take place because Jason Hanna was across the line of scrimmage.
Looked like it was going to be a straight handoff right up the middle, and Jason Hanna came across. St. James offside will be first down again for
three more cracks.
Would you play action pass or go up the middle, Tom?
I'd still play action pass. On third down.
Okay, so you go up the middle right now. Well, I'd give the ball to Kensley Palmer and I'd say, get it in there, kid.
No, it looks like Cassie's
Here's
taking
Cassie.
It himself.
Cassie, he can't get much penetration.
I don't believe it.
Back it up.
He's still not in.
That's number six.
How much space does he have?
I don't know. No. Like, even Kooky's fan club can't believe this.
Well,
time's being eaten away on the clock. Perhaps we can end the game on this one play.
The way things are going for St. Patel, they'll get a time count violation.
Well, they sent in the backup quarterback here, Weeb, and he's lined up as a wide receiver on the left. Maybe we will see a pass.
There's the look. They give it. Incredible.
I don't believe it.
No touchdown yet.
Like, can you imagine what the offensive coach is feeling like, the offensive line coach is feeling like right now?
Time for the play action pass, Larry. It's third down.
Well, they're sending in number 27, and that is Doug Sinclair, and he's taking out Darren Weave, so maybe, maybe not. 3 minutes
maybe
left.
Maybe they should go for the field goal.
That was a shot of our press box here. Very nice.
Very
compliments
nice
to St. Patel organization. They just built this, I think, about a month ago, and it's just a great addition here to this complex they've got.
Here it is.
Oh, quarterback rolling left. He gets good pressure. He might make it. There's the tackle.
No touchdown.
What defense are you believing?
Seven cracks to get a touchdown from inside the five-yard line in this stop. What a great job by the Rod defense. Once again, I got to mention their names again. Larrigan, Marigolese, Turner, Schneider, Hannah, Scarlett, Rawhouse, Kelly, Johnson, Reynolds, Nathaniel, and Steinhubel. Cassie's running for his life. Dragged down from deep behind by Nathaniel, the defensive back. What? That was one of the best defensive stands I've seen in a long, long time.
John Madden would have loved it.
You know what I wish had happened, though? It was offside St. James, and we could see another.
You're a sick man, Tom Sherwood.
In the end zone, they give straight ahead. I think that's probably Clooner again.
I think it's Clooner, number 20, yep.
Yeah, he just sits his way through there. He's so low.
I feel for the offensive line coach of the St. Patel Mustangs. It just must be killing. I bet he tried to put on a helmet and run in there himself to open a hole.
I may be mistaken, but I think the offensive line coach is Ed Tatro. And Ed was a fellow that I played with a while back. No, Ed Tatro's the defensive line coach and linebackers. Actually, it's Mike Brown who's the offensive line coach.
There's a big hole coming through.
I think he wants Jones his name mentioned.
Probably about a five-yard pickup close to a first down.
Speaking of Mike Brown, there's also Mike Brown involved with the St. James Rods. He's the trainer of the team. And Mike and I go back a ways. We were in university together, and he's doing a good job whenever any of the Rods are down on one knee because of an injury.
First down, St. James.
Score is... 50-0, and we have 1 minute and 30 seconds left here in the third quarter.
Okay, still a quarterback. They haven't switched. They give it to Clooner again. He takes it outside. He's got 16, 1-1. If he gets around them, no, but he's got the first down. And if you're a St. James fan, you're happy with that because it's eating a lot of time off the clock here.
Nice tackle by number 16, and that is little Brad, Scott Brand, who got across and grabbed Clooner. And we're seeing some interesting signs there.
Well, just watch how fast little Clooner is. And they have crossing action, some kind of crossing action in the backfield. There's Clooner. He's going to get outside beyond number 16, but 16 holds on and drags him down. That was Brand? Yeah, right, Scott Brand, 16.
There's the pitch to Clooner this side of the field. Schwab's in good position to throw a block, but somebody came in there for Savatel from behind and made a nice tackle. Good defense, Savatel, 59.
Well, there is a flag down on the play, and there's a look at little Clooner. And Stino Saragusa made the tackle on the play.
Nice place.
Now, when St. Vital usually employs 95 Zoltenko at the outside linebacker.
Right.
And I notice he's not in. Are they making substitutions, or would he be injured?
I bet right now that the heart really is out of St. Vital. The game is pretty well over. You know, there's not a chance in the world that they could come back from 50-0 unless, you know, the Rods pull their team off the field. But, you know, what's the odds of that happening?
There's a rough play.
Really, right now, there's a rough play called against St. James Rods. But really, you might as well let the guys, the lesser lights, the younger guys, get some playing experience. They're going to be your team next year. And that's exactly what Jim Ladd's doing. I got to commend him on that. Getting some of the young guys in there. You know, they can't do much worse than their starters have done for this game.
That's right, Larry. It's been a group effort. There's the pass out there. I think Jones has got it. He's wide open. He's going to be close to a first down.
Roll out pass. Jones wide open. And remember earlier in the game when the quarterback rolled out and Jones was wide open and the quarterback waited too long before he threw it to him. Well, that time he threw it at the right time when Jones was wide open. And it's not going to be enough for a first down.
Really, Tom, with 24 seconds left in this third quarter, the Rods up by 50 points, 50-0. We're having a look at a very dejected St. Patel bench. We haven't seen the St. Patel Mustangs that we have seen in the past play today. Third down punting attempt coming right away, right now from the St. James Rods.
Yeah, this game is really going to haunt St. Patel. You wonder, how can you come up this flat in the championship game? There's Kenzie Palmer. He takes the punt. He just knocked out of bounds, so right on the 50-yard line.
And Bob, you mentioned the word flat. I remember, Larry, you alluded to the fact that when St. Patel came out to start the game, they were really fired up.
They were fired up. They were cheering, ranting, and raving. And you'll take a look at the St. James Rods. They came walking off their bus. You know, they're casually talking. There was really no outward emotion. They went through their cowl. There was really no ranting or raving, and I'm telling you, St. Patel, if you win games on sounds and looks, the score would be reversed right now.
You know, the St. James, though, came out and blocked that punt in the end zone early in the first quarter, and that was the ball game, it looks like. There's Cassie. He hangs it up incomplete over the middle. A little congestion there with defensive backs and receivers.
Well, it was intended for 85, Paul Palmer. He seems to be pretty upset on the play. I think he believes he was interfered with. The ball was overthrown. No way Bob could have caught it.
Mercifully, the third quarter's over for the St. Patel Mustangs. The score 50-0. Can we have a quick recap of some of the score?
Well, as quick as you can make
50-0.
Maybe the third quarter.
No, I've written it all down. I'm going to do the whole thing. I'm just going to mention names, though. Case. touchdowns today here for St. James. Armargalese has scored one. Ogwald has three. Schwab has one. Jones has one. Kluner has one. All of the touchdowns were converted by Martin except for one. So that would be one, two, three, four. About six converts for Martin and a safety touch.
Martin didn't kick the last one. Perhaps he was tired. But St. Patel's ball, second down and 10 to go from their own 51-yard line.
Yeah, we expect to see naturally lots of passing at this point in the game for St. Patel here. Cassie goes back, gets a good protection this time, deep to number 80, Tom. That's a play we talked about earlier in the game. I guess we'd seen that receiver get open several times a couple of weeks ago.
Weiser had a great game. He's number 80, and he's a wide out on the right side on that particular play. They utilized him effectively on play action when they played that game over at Westwood, but they haven't thrown the ball to him much today. Yes,
well,
Larry.
Weiser was open in the middle. It's tough to get a word in edgewise here, so I have to have my mouth open to indicate that Tom wanted to say something. Weiser was open in the middle. Passage just
I get the impression the words that you're hearing aren't making you that interested because a big, big yawn coming out of your mouth.
There's Cassie. Good pass this time, but nice defense. Back just arrived in time. I missed the number there, but it was a good
69.
Play.
Number 69. That's Derek Dirks.
Yeah, Derek Dirks, defensive back, was in the game. He's getting a chance to play a little bit, and he did a good job jumping across and knocking the ball down. And we have a visitor to our booth, Tom.
Oh, yes, so we do.
Technical. We always need a little
technical operations behind the scenes. But the St. James Rods take over on downs on the St. Patel Mustangs 50-yard line with the score, coincidentally enough, 50-0 for the Rods.
There's a good-looking play for St. James, and Steinhuber. We haven't heard a lot about him today, but he makes a nice reception for about a 17-yard pickup.
Defensively, we've heard of Steinhuber. He was starting at corner, but he's also a backup running back, and he just leaked out of the backfield on that play. And nice play.
Yeah, and actually, St. James has decided to change their quarterback. It's number 7. He's rolling out. That's Peck, and he sees Steinhuber over there close to the sidelines.
Yeah, Peck's a good-looking quarterback. We saw him in Bantam action last year. Really liked him, and look at the kid. He's about 6'4". He was 6'2" in Bantam. He barks out the signals. He just has a nice touch on his pitch. He sends it to Kluner this side of the field, but 82 has position on Kluner and trips him up from behind. A nice defensive play by 82 for the Mustangs.
That's Rennie Russo, that fine roving linebacker. He's had a tough day today, but he did a good job catching up to Kluner, number 20, as he rounded the corner and stopped him before a first down.
I think we're probably going to hear a lot of Rennie in junior football. He's probably going to go on with the junior Mustangs. And here we see the pitch, reverse pivot. Here's Kluner. Gets away from one tackler, and he's more or less running to the sideline rather than upfield.
Boy, and he's quick.
Yeah, he certainly is. A little guy, but legs in motion constantly.
Oh, legs just a chugging away.
And another St. Patel penalty, making it first and five.
Well, one thing that you have to give the St. James Rods, they've put in some of their lesser lights right now, and they're still marching the ball. That shows depth on that team.
Except that the quality of their backups is pretty good. Number 7, Peck's a good quarterback.
Yeah, it just has such a nice touch there, Tom. I just watched him pitch that ball. Not too hard, just right. Easy to handle. Here's Kluner trying to get outside. He keeps driving. Takes a tough hit.
Yeah, well, with those legs churning up and down, and he's kind of low to the ground, it's sort of hard to wrap up.
Well, he went to his right and cut back to his left. He's got good peripheral vision. He finds that hole.
Here's a shot again of this. Keep your eye on the number 20's legs. He just keeps it churning and chugging. They finally get him.
Those legs are just constantly moving.
He takes a good smack there.
Oh, but that second hit player in really gave him a shot.
Well, it looks like we're going to have our first measurement of the game.
I'd like to remind our viewers, stay tuned next Sunday morning for more amateur football action. We're going to have the championship game in the Winnipeg Affiliated Football League's 13-year-old division with the River Heights Cardinals playing St. Patel, and then we have the Bantam Championship coming up right after that with Transcona Nationals and again the St. Patel Mustangs. But the big question is, will St. Patel have any championship hardware to take home this year?
It's been a, well, they did win the Manitoba Junior Football Conference, but they didn't have much success against Ottawa.
There's a shot of St. James, the double blue. It's just been a solid wave of blue today all day long.
First down, St. James, and Peck's at quarterback.
Oh, here's a nice look at that play inside the Steinhogel. Touchdown, St. James.
What a nice,
what a view.
What a play call.
Okay, what a play, what a view, and we've seen it before.
We'll see it again.
We'll see it again. I think that Patrick Jones had scored on that one earlier.
Well, Steinhogel steps off the defense to go on as a backup running back, and there we'll take a look at him. He was a big star in Bantam last year for the St. James Rods on a bit of a, like a fake pitch counter.
Yeah, well, it's like we see that belly motion, and instead of just sort of taking it all the way to the other side of the field, he just cuts it up between the guard and the center.
And no one touched him.
Nobody.
Hey, Tom, like being an offensive coach, like when the quarterback brings the ball up in the fake there, is he supposed to show it that high so the defense maybe gets a peek at it? Looks like he's pitching it?
I think the intention is to let the defense see it, and also they want to show the pitch kind of action because they want to influence people to the outside.
Boy, very well executed. People on that play was a big hole. The culvert was good. Making the score 57-0 for the St. James Rods over these hapless Mustangs. What a long, long afternoon it's been for poor Jim Ladd.
And you can see the sign, Rods Rule, and there certainly are ruling today.
And the
signs all over the place here today.
Fellas, the irony of it is, I guess St. Patel was the big push behind going to 15-minute quarters in midget football. And
well, I guess right now they're ruining the day. Ruining the day. The game would be over now, and there's still 12 minutes and 27 seconds left, and it's a long, long day.
Now, we saw a young Rod fan with the Rod's Rule sign. Have we seen a close-up yet of that other fan with the Hogs placard? I hope we get to see him somewhere.
No,
there's Weiser with the ball. He brings it out over the 25. He's out to about the 30-yard line.
Number 50 hit him in the air. That would be Daryl Parisian, a guard, and he's shaken up on the play for the Rods.
Can't the possible penalty occur sometimes when people hurdle other people?
You can't step on a person and jump off of them, use them as a springboard. So on that play there, he tried to just hurdle over. He was hit by number 50, Parisian, and both guys were sort of slightly shaken up. The St. Patel kid got up quickly, but being helped off the field now.
The Rods ball carrier took to the air to hurdle somebody, and I wonder if you've ever seen that NFL highlight with, I think it's Billy Sims giving somebody a karate kick on a hurdle.
Pushing off. Yeah, that's right.
I've seen that highlight.
St. Patel, first down. Weaves in a quarterback. He swings it out. The Palmer's got it. But a good tackle. Jars the ball loose by number 56 for St. James. We'll give him a little plug. That's Steve Doyle. What a linebacker.
Steve Doyle did a good job man coverage on Palmer.
I was just going to say that. Palmer's a good running back. He's quick, and the linebacker was right on him in the flats.
And Steve Doyle didn't even start the game. That shows the kind of depth that these Rods have. That kid, you know, a lot of quickness here. We'll see on the replay. Palmer leaks out of the backfield. Nice throwing ball, and Doyle's right there. Good coverage by Steve Doyle, number 56.
Great replay on that. Great replay.
Do the Rods look any smaller with their backups in there?
Not really, no.
Whew, what a team.
Never has a powder blue team looked so dominant.
You can hear the crunching on that play, and Jason Rawhouse is one of the guys that put the finishing touches on the running back, and little or no gain. That'll make it now third down and about 8 yards to go for a first. Looks like the punting team is rolling onto the field.
Well, at this point in the, at this juncture in the game, it is 57-0 in favor of St. James. Not much possibility of St. Patel coming back. Well, we take a miracle.
I don't know. Like Jim McGregor just came over our earphones. He's not sure. He's sticking with this game to the end. I guess we still have a few donuts left in the truck.
There's a high snap. They get. Oh, there it is. Pretty good rush that time. Nice punt. Nice punt on the play. There, the ball is knocked out of bounds by St. Patel.
A good block downfield by number 57, Rawhouse. There was a St. Patel Mustang sort of standing there and waiting to make the tackle, and Rawhouse just drilled him out of bounds. And it looks like Jones is a little slightly shaken up on the play as he went out of bounds. He possibly twisted his ankle or something. And
well, St. Patel's going to have... Oh, Kooky Bears fan club.
What?
Kooky Bears fan club.
I wonder.
There are some of the charter members of the fan club.
Right. And, you know, like, they're a very vocal group right in front of us here in the booth, and they've done a lot of cheering. They've chanted the whole third quarter, "We want Coogie."
And they love their Coogie, don't they?
They love their Coogie bear.
There's that pitch. It's going to be a reverse to 26. I like it. Oh, he got a little block there. If he could just get outside, one of his own linemen stopped him momentarily. But 26 with the ball.
Well, he got a little block. He got a little block there, but from his own man on himself.
I don't know. A 59 for Saint Patel. I believe that was
Stino Saracusa.
Okay, well, he felt a block delivered by the quarterback, number 7, Peck. I watched it. And if we get to see it on the replay, there was a lot of different people handling the ball there. And here's a replay.
An interesting lead up to the replay.
Okay, and we just missed Peck's block.
There's a good block there by number 56 on his own man. But okay. That was gain about 4 yards on the play.
There's Peck. He's going to keep the ball this time, and he gets about a 5-yard pickup. He's going to leave him 2 or 3 yards short of
the
first down.
Pretty close to a first down. Now, a little drop back pass. I believe they were going for something short. Nobody was open right away, so Peck decided to take off with it.
Rods are putting the ball away, and that'll hammer the St. Paul Mustangs deep into their own end once again. But Coogie's fan club below us is really ranting and raving. Now, I think Coogie may have made an appearance out of the truck.
There's a nice shot of one of the younger viewers here at today's game, probably playing checkers down in front of him to keep his interest up. 9:30 to go.
With the score 57-0 with the Rods over these 4 Mustangs, it's taking a lot to keep the interest of some of the fans here.
Well, I'm running out of paper, to tell you the truth, for the scoring summary. And
well, needless to say, Bob Whitlaw will provide you with some, and I'll just mention the coaching staff again for these St. James Rods, the all-star coaching staff. Head coach of Norm Rawhouse, he's been around for quite a while. Gordy Rowland, offensive back coach. Ben Langhams, the linebacker coach. Great job the defense have done so far. Paul Decker, the line coach. Eric Cotier, another line coach who's been with Pop Warner for quite a few years. Bob Turner, the manager. Reg Siemens, one of the trainers, and Mitch Cosman, the team doctor. It's good to see a team doctor. He's out with the
And don't forget Mike Brown, the trainer, and Al Hayes, who's helping out a little bit.
Oh,
and
we can't forget A.J. Hayes.
And Brian Schwab, the manager. Or did you mention?
There's Scarlett. He kicks the ball to our side of the field. It's coming down around the 30-yard line, where it's going to be fielded by Palmer. He bobbles it. Oh, I thought he'd give it a bounce. But all of a sudden, the pursuit arrives. And they probably savor every minute of it. There's a cheap shot in the back by 82 for St. Patel.
That's
totally uncalled for. That has to be the cheap shot of the game, number 82, St. Patel.
Rennie Russo, fine linebacker, very frustrated. It's sad to see him do something like that, but we've seen a few questionable things. And
well, the score is 57-0, and you would think that people, ball players for St. Patel, are very frustrated right now. We're going to see the punt by Scarlett.
Here's rough play on both teams. So here's
now,
the replay.
Now watch Palmer. He's going to hold on to the jersey of his blocker. You're going to see this in a minute. See? He's tugging, holding on to number 17's jersey.
Now they're milling around, and maybe we'll see Russo come flying in there.
No, that happened just a little bit to the
Russo
right.
We see Russo flying out of there now, though. Like, I think we're going to see rough play called against both sides, but you know, that's something you don't have to do. There's still 9 minutes left in the game. If you really want to hit somebody, you can get somebody legally somewhere along the line, Rennie. You don't have to take
Russo has his opportunity anytime he's out there on defense. He's a linebacker.
The head official, Slobodian, Gary Slobodian.
Just to mention, the Manitoba Midget Football League executive, the president is Bill Dunstone, the secretary is Otto Gebhardt. Contact people from each team. That's Bill Dunstone from St. Patel, Lloyd Urbanowski from Fort Garry, Darlene Ringer from St. Boniface, Norm Rawhouse from the Rods of St. James, Otto Gebhardt again from the Lockport Cowboys, Britt Angus from the Transcona Nationals, and Doug Steves for the Crocus Plains Plainsmen.
Well, it was rough play both sides, and it'll be a first down for St. Patel on their own 31-yard line.
And we have about 9 minutes left in the game. It's 57-0 in favor of St. James.
Well, Weave is back in at quarterback. Should have been revolving quarterbacks for the Mustangs. Neither is Cassidy or Weave to get the team rolling.
Yeah, Weave's looking right all the way. Nice little fake. He hangs it up. Palmer got an early hit there, but what a remarkable reception, Tom.
Well, it was a fine reception. I believe there was going to be interference on the play because Palmer got hit before the ball was there. We had some kind of crossing pattern where Palmer on the inside got outside. He was hit by number 34, Kelly Yoon. But he caught the ball anyway. Let's see it again. And here's the replay.
Good catch by Palmer.
Beautiful replay.
Grabbed the ball. Kelly Yoon hit him. It wasn't a dirty hit or anything. He just mistimed his hit. And probably one of the bigger plays we've seen for the St. Patel Mustangs, other than that nice drive they had in the middle of the third quarter.
Well, I guess the St. James defense is really going for the shutout. That would be quite a way to finish their season in the championship game, shutting out St. Patel.
That's right.
There's a play to Palmer. Oh, a big hole open. He might go 43. I don't think he'll catch it, but will he? No. St. Patel. Cheap shot, 67. Undoubtedly the second stupidest play I've ever seen.
I wonder if that cheap shot, and that's a perfect word for it, a disgusting play by number 67,
Perry French,
hit the guy dead in the back, but I wonder if the Palmer's over the goal line. But here on the replay, we'll see. It opens up. No one touches Palmer. Just straight. He's running into the end zone.
Well, it was a trap play. One of the interior linemen for St. Patel had pulled down and blocked downfield. And number 67, unaccountably, I don't know why he would do what he did, but he hit.
One of the St. James Rods smacked a St. Patel Mustang blocker down the field, and then St. Patel crunched the guy from behind French, but it was after Palmer crossed the goal line. The touchdown will stand, making the score 57-6. The St. James Rods over the Mustangs. And there's a sign walking in front of us, Stangbusters.
I'm wondering just how long that sign is going
to
last.
Today. There's a convert attempt, and it's wide to the right.
And there's a lot of hard feelings between the two teams right now. We still got 8 minutes and 14 seconds to go. Score 57-6. Really, it's inconsequential, the score. It's pretty well over. The Rods are way ahead of the Mustangs, but a lot of ill feeling by both teams. And there's another flag down on the play.
Unfortunately, I guess we're hoping this game would sort of showcase the Midget Football League, and it's turning a little sour.
The score is 57-6. That was a beautiful run by Kensley Palmer up the middle. Now, there was a trap block, and I believe it was the left guard blocked downfield.
Well, we're seeing Rennie Russo being helped off the field. He's limping, and perhaps he took a little shot somewhere along the line. But usually linemen on the Rods, they won't forget something like that. And the convert's attempt will be taken over again. There was an offside on the Rods.
Bateman attempting the convert for St. Patel.
Here's a good snap. They go for the fake. Wide open is Palmer, but they could have passed, but I think Weeb's going to run it in for 2 points.
There's another flag thrown on the play, and it was thrown in the area of the lineman. Perhaps we'll see a holding call. But Weeb did scamper into the end zone.
And there's another flag on the play.
Big 61 picks up the flag. That's Mark Christian. It was kind of interesting today. I was here early, and Mark Christian was here 1 hour before the game. He was here all by himself, all dressed before the team came in the bus. I guess he'd been somewhere else, probably had to dress somewhere and come to the game. He just sat on the bench, thought about the game.
Big kid. But it looks like the two-point convert will stand. Weeb scampering around the right side for the two-pointer, making the score of Rods 57, St. Patel 8. Let's hope we get no more of these incidences of cheap shots and late hits. Yeah, it's been a pretty well-played game by both teams as far as rules and regulations go and clean, well-developed football. But lately, late in the game here, we've been seeing some tempers flaring on both sides.
There's a shot of the screen of the young boys there with that poster. It says Stangbusters.
Well, the Stangbuster little banner that walked in front of us was ripped apart by one of the fans.
And that is the highlight of the day for St. Patel, believe me. St. Patel going for the short kick here, probably. I think they'll go to the wide side. They squib it along there, but it doesn't go the necessary yards. But St. Patel covers the ball. Anyways, good coverage by St. James.
Number 55 on that play. That's Andy Lessig, tackle on the play. Who got across. Good hands for a lineman.
Sure. We saw Lessig jump on the ball. And actually, I don't think it has to go 10 yards, providing the receiving team stops it within the 10 yards.
If the receiving team stops the ball, and let's say Andy Lessig would have hit his chest and bounced free, the Mustangs could have recovered without the ball having to go the 10 yards.
Yeah, St. James was, you know, alert and onto that play, anticipating it naturally. I guess everybody in the ballpark knew it was coming. We saw some great execution on a short kick in a high school game last week, I think. Or was it the Kelvin Clippers trying to make a comeback there, executed probably the best short kick I've seen. Here comes the reverse to this side of the field. They pitch it back to Peck, but he didn't fool anybody. He steps up to throw. Ooh, takes a vicious hit. Open on the play is Martin. What a play, St. James.
He didn't fool many people, but the D-back.
Okay. Did Peck ever pay for it?
Now, I watched Martin downfield. He was open for about 10 seconds. And he just had to wait for the play to develop and Peck to see him and throw the ball downfield.
I was watching a nice play by number 88, the outside linebacker, Merrithew. We'll see him come at the bottom of your screen here. He's right in Peck's face. Peck just steps up. Good calmness there by that quarterback.
Peck gives it to Clooner. Clooner gives it to Newberry. Newberry gives it back to Peck, and Peck throws downfield to Martin. First down, St. James. Martin's down on the play.
Well, Martin's shaken up on the play. The doctor's still out there talking to him, and
Martin
and really, another big play by the Rods.
He's really done a lot of running today, running, kicking.
And kicking. He's kicked six converts.
That's right. Yep. Kickoff.
No one was fooled.
Well,
the poor defensive back. It's been a long day for the Mustangs.
Again, if any of you viewers are still up this late on a Sunday night, a reminder to tune in next Sunday morning. Catch the Bantam Championship and the Winnipeg Affiliated Football League's 13-year-old championship. The River Heights Cardinals are going to play St. Patel in the 13-year-old championship. There's Peck looking in the end zone. Nice pattern. Steinhubel, touchdown.
Well,
what a nice pass.
That was the semi-roll. Steinhubel just, I guess, kind of a flare pattern down the sidelines, like a fade pattern.
Well, I think the St. James Rods coaching staff is saying, you know, a little signal to the St. Patel coach staff. Listen, we're going to play out the string, and you guys want to take a few cheap shots? Okay, we'll start running up the score.
Well, Steinhubel, we saw there on the replay, Steinhubel ran it out, and then he turned it up down the sidelines, and he was wide open.
Wide touchdown. Open, another touchdown, making the score 63-8 for the Rods. Convert to come.
Yeah, there's
Is Martin back in there?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's lining up the convert. Nice little chip shot there directly through for
that
a
That was probably his best convert attempt all day. It was, you know, straight through. And makes the score 64-8.
There's a shot at
Rods over the Mustangs.
St. James supporters there really enjoying proceedings today, that's for sure.
St. Patel has managed to put up 9 touchdowns today on the scoreboard. 8 converts go with those 9 touchdowns and 1 safety touch.
Well, still 7 minutes and 21 seconds. It's been a long fourth quarter, Tom.
In the second half, St. Vitale has been close. How many times did they have an opportunity when they were within the, say, 3 yards?
7.
7. And we did finally see Palmer score the 1 touchdown. I think I called 64-9. 64-8.
Martin kicks the ball to Rob Palmer. He picked up a nice downfield play. I think it's 43, probably was the linebacker there. Ron Hutter,
back to linebacker, got down the field very fast, made the tackle. Nice initial hit. St. Vitale has the ball on their own 35-yard line.
Well, there's 7 minutes and 17 seconds left.
For Martin.
Well, we've seen a lot of things today. We've seen long touchdown passes, short runs, some reverses, Coogie Bears fan club. What more can we have? The Hog Squad sign over there?
Okay.
We're seeing it all.
This is the Manitoba Amateur Football Association Game of the Week here. This is Midget Championship Football. There's Wee passing to 26. Oh, a nice tackle, and they tried to strip the ball as he tackled him. I like it. Number 24.
Number 26 for the Mustangs was wide open. Zabrowski's wide open for the longest time. Wee just didn't throw it.
Well, there were two little, I guess you might call them curl-out patterns. Palmer ran one on this side as well, 85. We're going to see it again. Here's Weeb rolling out. He's got Palmer in front of him. He's also got Zabrowski, 26. And the tackler tried to pull the ball loose. And then he was able to make the tackle.
Kelly Young, the tackler on the play, short little guy playing safety right now for the Rods.
First down, Mustangs. Nice fake by Weeby. Fools number 18, Nathaniel. He gets outside, throws back, intended for number two for St. Patel. Pass incomplete. A nice looking play.
Well, that was the very same play, only this time the quarterback rolled out and looked backside. And he had the flanker or the wide out on the backside running, a post pattern.
I never thought I'd see the day. Number two, there we see on the screen. Louis Cassie would go downfield to catch a pass out at Maples. He was the ultimate quarterback, drop back quarterback, and never thought of him much of as a receiver. And he didn't catch the pass, so.
Well, there was good coverage provided by number 43.
Yeah,
he stayed with Cassie
Hutter
the whole time.
Yeah, Hutter did a good job right there. That'll make it second down and 10 to go.
Oh, there's a little early movement by Rob Palmer offside. His brother Kensley gets the ball, and look at that pursuit. Whoa.
Well, I think what we'll probably see is the Rods just declined the penalty. Really, they didn't gain much yardage on the play.
Well,
Palmer's wrapped up the second he got the ball.
Palmer was definitely, Bob Palmer, that is, was definitely offside. And then Kensley had to fight off, what, 7, 8, 9 Rods?
Everything was blue around him, that's for sure. Third down and 10 yards to go. It looks like the Rods are the Mustangs are going to go for it. They got nothing to lose.
Well, they're picking up the yard markers over there on the far side of the field, an indication that
turn out the lights, the party's
yeah,
on.
I think so.
Somebody crank up that scoreboard. Third and 10. Oh, there's the big rush. Nice pass by Weeb. Good reception by Kensley Palmer. First down, St. Patel.
Well, play action pass. It was a nice pass by Weeb, and Palmer ran straight down the field. Fly pattern, and it was just...
They leaked him through the line of scrimmage.
Right, I believe they faked to him. Maybe we'll see it again on the replay, but I think they faked it to him and then threw it to him straight downfield.
It was good coverage by Hutter, but we'll see. Straight down the field, nice pass, and Hutter was there. So is number 56 for the Rods. That's Doyle. But a good first down for the
great
Mustangs.
Great reception. The quarterback never saw it. There's Weave. Nice fake. He hangs it up again. Oh, tip. James, the intended receiver.
James
the ball
was open.
Thrown a little deeper. He was open, Tom.
James was behind some people, and he was open.
Big number 40 for the Rods. That's Hannah. Came across the line of scrimmage. He had his hands right in Weave's face. Weave couldn't see very far downfield there. Had to get rid of the ball a lot quicker than he wanted to. Second and 10 from the 40-yard line of the Rods. 5:07 left in this game. The score, Tom.
Well, I'm just watching the banner, guys, to see what happens there. 64-8.
And Rods' revenge banner sort of makes it back.
What's left of it.
And one of the coaches up in the booth here goes and yells down to the fans who are carrying the banner, hey, get back by our supporters. We don't want to cause any trouble out there with the St. Patel people. And they listened rather nicely.
St. James will sure savor this victory, that's for sure. They've worked a few years towards this one.
Well, have we got a timeout called by the Mustangs, Tom?
I'm not quite sure what the timeout is for. Yeah, I think Mustangs call the timeout. 64-8 in favor of St. James.
Yeah. Well, here comes Weed back onto the playing field.
It was
second and 10. Perhaps it was a timeout called by these Mustang coaching staff. Never give up. 5 minutes left in the game.
Here's an injured St. Patel player making his way back to the locker room on the far side of the field. We're not sure of the number there. We'll check that out for you. There's Weeb, nice fake. They try the guard around the 65. I like it, Tom. 65, he's going. Ooh, great tackle by 43, Ron Hutter.
The old Doug Krochak made famous guard around play.
Well, perhaps he's standing at the sideline and he set that play in, but that was Kineski, the left guard, carrying the ball. And we're going to see it again. Weeb's going to make it look like a fake, and you can see he faked out our cameraman, make it look like a pitch.
Well, what happens on that play there? The center snaps the ball up. The quarterback doesn't take it. The center holds it by his leg.
And the guard
offside
runs.
Guard grabs the ball from the center and runs around. Well, well set up play.
Good execution that time.
And a good first down.
Oh, there's Weed. He sprints out. Gets a good block by 67. Knocked out of bounds by 36 for St. James and Sterrell Johnson.
You called it right, Bob. He got a beautiful block by number 67, French, Perry French. He came back and picked off one of the pursuing line, I think it was a lineman for St. James, and Weeb was able to get around the corner. It's going to be second and two.
Four minutes, 30 seconds remaining in this ball game, which St. James, I guess, has dominated from the opening minute there when they blocked the punt very early in the ball game, fell on it for a touchdown. Actually blocked it once, and it was called back. Savatel had the punt again. They blocked it twice, and I guess that was an indicator what kind of day it was going to be. There's a reverse. It doesn't work. 61 Christian and 56 for St. James there. Fall on the ball. Finally covering it. 56 Steve Doyle.
Well, it was the Palmer brothers. Pitched to Bob Kensley Palmer, who was going to hand it off to Bob on the reverse.
And there is Christian. Fumble. Here on the replay, we'll see Christian, pitch. Number 61, and 56 Doyle right there. Ball bounces around loose, and Doyle, another big play for him. And another scoring threat by the Mustangs snuffed out. And there's Coogie Bear's end zone, and we'll get a VPW exclusive of Coogie Bear's lair.
But he's hibernating right now.
That's right. I think rumor of donuts in the front of the truck has caught him out of his lair, and
cinnamon donuts too.
Ooh.
I would think being a Coogie Bear, he'd like honey donuts.
There's a nice fake by Peck. He's looking over the middle, but he swings it out to Scarlett. Got all kinds of room. He has a nice 30-yard pickup. Nice play for St. James.
Scarlett, again, is an outside linebacker on defense, playing a bit of offense right now.
You see him on offense occasionally. He caught the ball out in the flat. Nice-looking play. Maybe we'll get to see it again on the replay. Yeah, there it is, and there's Peck. You see Scarlett out in the flat. Just wanted to mention that we've got Daryl Parisien in there playing right guard right now for St. James, number 50.
Well, Rod's on the march again.
Coming up to the three-minute warning here. This is Midget Football League action. Anybody just getting home late on a Sunday night, these boys are high school age. They come from the different communities. They don't operate out of a school.
What a
there's
nice
Peck,
fake.
Yeah, nice fake over the middle. The ball was dropped. A pretty good looking play. Would have been about an 8-yard pickup.
Yeah, there was very good ball handling on the play by number 7, Peck. Carried out a nice fake and had the ball down on his hip there, and it just was a fine looking play. I see Jowett's in there as well, number 26.
That was a real nice play by Peck. Jowett, he was out at the, I believe, the Bomber Development Camp and the Peace Corps.
Oh, there's an older Jowett, the
quarterback. Yeah, there's a Jowett that plays for Brandon.
Yeah, I believe there was also at that Bomber Development Camp, there was a quarterback, Jowett from St. James,
okay.
Too.
That's right, he's too old this year. He was out with the juniors, I think, as a backup.
This could be a brother.
There's a nice pitch. Nice play. It was open to Scarlett. Oh!
Larry,
the pursuit arrived.
Larry, how are they making that play work so easily, just having that running back in the flat?
Well, St. Patel right now is defense. Isn't playing the kind of structured defense and well-disciplined defense that we're used to seeing. They're all going out sort of headhunting, just sort of freelancing on the play. And what we're seeing here, the quarterback just fakes, gets outside the contain. There's no linebacker there, and just dumps it off to Scarlett. Scarlett gets the ball, and there's guys all over the field. They're just not in the position they should be.
Yeah, Andrew Swan threw a real nice block in that last play, and there's Steinhobel was wide open. He cuts back, gets the ball, dropped the ball. I think Savatel's got it. We'll see what they rule.
Well,
Savatel ball.
Pretty simple pattern. Steinhobel just runs it out, and he turns it up, and he beat the defender. It was 17 beating 17.
And he was hit, and the ball popped loose and was recovered by the safety, number 28, Wes Miller.
These St. James quarterbacks have looked so good today.
Cool,
can't believe
calm,
it.
Big, good arms, good mobility. This team here, you know, like they draw from the whole St. James area and just outside in the Headingley area, and they draw from the high schools out there, Westwood, Sturgeon Creek, St. James Collegiate, Silver Heights, and probably even as far as into Headingley.
A great sign for the day, fellas.
Rod's rule, they certainly do today.
Score 64-8. It was 30-0 at halftime, and St. James has come back and put 34 more points up on the board.
Yeah, with a little luck, their Bantam team could have been that championship game tomorrow, but they just came up a little flat. There's James was wide open to this side of the field.
Well, in fairness to Weave, he had big number 61, Mark Christian, right in his face. Defensive end on the play. Had to get rid of the ball a lot quicker than he wanted to.
That was a good play for Savatel. I don't know how they got James on 56, but if he'd ever caught that ball, he might have gone for a touchdown. I think there's nobody else in his area.
Yeah, there was a lot of room to scamper down the sideline. 2 minutes and 19 seconds left in this fourth quarter. Score, Rod, 64, the Mustangs 8.
Yeah, on behalf of all the Midget football coaches, too, I'd like to thank Channel 13, all of the technical people, for coming out and doing this game today. It was appreciated by the Midget people. Here's a reverse to this side of the field. shades of Sean Funk when he played with the Zavatel Midgets. 27 doing a good job running the ball there. I don't think we called him too often.
No.
Doug Sinclair.
Yeah, that was Doug Sinclair, number 27. It was the reverse play of number 11 Weeb giving it to Sinclair. Good looking play, but it's
too
basically academic. Yeah, it's.
They've had a few nice plays this fourth quarter. They should have brought him out of the old bag of tricks in this first half. Well, it's third down, 1 yard to go, and they didn't have much success on going up the middle on short yardage when they had a chance for a touchdown. I wonder what we'll see here.
Yeah, that was a very memorable goal line stand by St. James, that's for sure. And there's the pitch to Palmer. He cuts it up, lowers his head, and he easily has the first down.
Well, that time they decided not to go inside. They pitched it to Palmer going to the left, and they've got the first down. Minute and 43 seconds left.
Well, Norm Rawhouse, if you're watching this telecast, congratulations, buddy. You deserve it. You've worked very hard over the years, and
you
must be very proud of your team.
I had an opportunity to work with Norm at the Bomber Development Camp, and Norm's a good guy.
There's a nice pass. Attended for Weiser. He caught it. What a good reception. I think Hunter brings him down from behind, but just a nice play for Savitt.
Well,
but they needed that in the first half.
Fly pattern, straight downfield, number 80, Steve Weiser catching the ball. And like, I was really impressed with Steve the last time these two teams played, and they just really haven't gone to him much.
Good hustle by Hunter, number 43, the linebacker on that play. He catches up to the receiver from behind, and, you know, good speed for a big linebacker like Hunter.
Fellas, isn't this a great place to broadcast the game from? Now we're getting a little used to it here. We're right at midfield, elevated just high enough.
Such a good view.
Some
of the
good
whole
shots there from our play-by-play camera, Brad. There's Weeb over the middle. Oh, the pass could have been caught. I think 23, the intended receiver there, and the pass is incomplete.
Number 22,
well, Derek Lee.
Derek Lee was in the open. It's just that the ball is delivered slightly behind him, and he lost concentration on it. And then he took a punishing hit after he dropped the ball by number 36, Daryl Johnson, defensive back for the Rods.
Winding down to nearly a minute remaining in the game. I know there's trophy presentations after the game. I don't think we'll be staying on for a lengthy post-game show, but we might catch some of the action in the background there as we wrap up after the game. They'll make the presentations to St. James right after the game.
We've got another timeout by the Rods. Tom, perhaps you've got some interesting tidbit of information to give us.
Well, I just wanted to mention that in other games today in this championship weekend, we had the Waffle 10-year-old final, Transcona 38, Greendale 8, the Midget final. Is the one you're seeing right now. Also, we had the Bantam Consolation. The Eastside Eagles were victorious over the Lockport Cowboys, 15-1. Yet to come will be the Waffle 11-year-old final and the Waffle 13-year-old final, and finally the Bantam Championship final. And we shouldn't forget that other football action this weekend features Pop Warner League finals, and that's out at the University of Manitoba.
The old Pop Warner League. We've seen a
bit of controversy
in the
Pop Warner League
in the paper, and needless to say, the Eskimos will be playing, I believe. We'll
that George Motosh, what a guy. He knows how to get the ink. There's a gift to James. He pops open up the middle. He's a good runner. He didn't finesse that tackler, did he?
No, he ran right over his face.
And, you know, it was just a simple, the quarterback takes the snap from center and gives to James. It was inside running. Here we go. We're going to see it again. And good timing. James was right there, and nice run.
Yeah, the tackler just submarined him there. First down for St. Vitale. You know, the quality of people St. Vitale has on this team, it just really makes me wonder, how good is this St. James team? Gee, you know, they beat them three times this year. They're just an outstanding team, St. James.
More
pass out to the side. That line is incomplete.
That wasn't a screen pass, was it? I didn't see any linemen out there.
It was a desperation pass. Number 40 for the Rods is right in his face. That's Hannah. He was right in the quarterback's face. He tried to swing it out to who he thought was an open
now pass. Look at the look on that fan's face. He just can't believe that play either. He wasn't sure what he's thinking. If that was a screen, where were the linemen out there blocking?
That's right. It's tough to understand sometimes, you know, like, why? What's going on with this team?
The ball's out around, I think, 12-yard line here. Second down for St. Vitale. James right up the middle, follows the big lineman, drives down to the 5-yard line. A good surge there.
Close to the first down. Time, 39 seconds left in this. Well, we got to call it the game. No, I doubt if we'll get overtime here. Score 64-8. Rods over the Mustangs.
How about Maybe, well, if anybody's listening this late at night, how about wishing the Ottawa Sooners good luck in their quest for the championship?
Okay.
Although I guess we should be cheering for Saskatoon Hilltops.
And who's Ottawa playing? They'll be going against
the Saskatoon Hilltops, who defeated the Richmond Raiders 25-24. The ball's loose. The rod's fall on it. Hey, a fitting end.
Guess what play that was? That was the guard around, I believe.
The guard around.
65, Kineski.
Well, number 53 for the Rods, Alan Margulies, who's done a great job defensively, scored the first touchdown of the game, prevents a touchdown with 19 seconds.
You know what St. James should do? They should show that they've got a guard around, too. I think they should give the ball to 52 Bill Dubeski and let him
Bill Dubeski. Last game we did, Bob Skowar and I figured Bill Dubeski's future calling will be a pro wrestler with that voice he's got.
Or a pro wrestling announcer.
Remember how many times we were woken up to, "Hi, coach, how are you this morning?"
And if VPW ever decides to do some more wrestling, perhaps Bill's their man.
Yeah.
19 seconds left. Packet quarterback, a long count. They give to Steinhubel. I think
he got blockers up there.
There's a wave of blue coming, and Steinhubel, if he gets by the last man, they won't catch him. He's a track man. Oh, what a way to wrap it up. How much time left?
Well, he almost ran out of time. There's 4 seconds left.
3 seconds
now I see nine. Actually.
No, the three looks like a nine.
Oh, okay.
I think that'll make the highlight package.
Well, we've got to see it again, and it just seemed to be everybody blocking for Steinhubel on the right. I think that's what. And let's go right. Here we see it again. It's a sweep. There's Steinhubel. Look at all the blue. There's some red. He gets by those two tacklers, and now the race is on.
Does a good job jumping around number 16 here. Keeps running. A good job by number 88. Got to give him credit. That's Chris Merrithew, the outside linebacker on the right side. The Rods are downing the ball. They've got the championship, 64-8 over these Mustangs.
Congratulations, St. James. You got it.
And just to recap the scoring, and I'll make it quick. Scores for St. James today, and they scored 9 touchdowns. Chris Ogwell got 3 of them. Steinhubel with 2, almost a third there. Schwab 1, Jones 1, Kluner 1, and Margulies opened the scoring by recovering a blocked punt. All the touchdowns, all 9 touchdowns were converted except for 1 by number 73 Martin. So he got 8 converts. There was also a safety touch. And Palmer scored the lone touchdown for St. Patel. And Weeds got the 2-point convert. So it ends up 64-8.
Well, it was an interesting game for the first 5 or 6 minutes, and the Rods just caught fire, and it was just a nightmare for the Mustangs. Offensively, defensively, whatever they tried just didn't work today. We've seen a little bit of shaky play in the third quarter, in the fourth, a few late hits, but it all cleared itself up as the game went on, and we're seeing good sportsmanship here. Both teams shaking hands, as it should be, and the Rods are the Manitoba Midget champions for the year 1985.
Ad-worthy champions. They played St. Patel 3 times, twice during the regular season, and here in the final, scored 64 points against St. Patel in their semifinal. They got 69 against Brandon, and they're a great team.
Well, a lot of happy faces, and I bet you one guy who's very happy is Ken Hunter, the head coach of the junior team. He's going to see a lot of these boys move up next year.
Yeah, we're going to leave you right now. We hope you've enjoyed this amateur football production here on Channel 13. Stay tuned next Sunday morning when you're going to catch Bantam Championship action and 13-year-old Championship action for the Waffle League. This is Bob Whitlaw for Tom Sherbrook, Larry Boding saying, keep watching amateur football.